to Coast AM Archives. You're listening to the best of Art Bell. This program was originally broadcast October 30th, 1993. Art will be live tomorrow night for his annual Ghost to Ghost AM show.
Good morning, and welcome to another edition of Coast to Coast AM. Live ghost stories all night long. This is an annual event, and I've got a number of things to say about it. Number one, I take this very seriously. And Halloween is about here. Halloween is tomorrow. And this is as close as we get with this program, and it's going to kind of be a little touch of, I suppose, some of Area 2000. What we do here on special occasions, we every now and then turn away from the news, whatever it happens to be. And it's not much this morning anyway. For now, we're going to delve into a whole different world, and one that I want to warn some of you is going to frighten you. And there are people who become upset by discussions involving the paranormal and ghosts. And if you are one of those people, I urge you right now to turn your radio off. Go watch TV or something. Listen to somebody else's radio program. Because this morning we're going off into a complete different world. And I've got a couple of setup pieces this morning that I think you'll enjoy. This story from the Associated Press, it's Dayline Capitol Hill. With its 200-year history, it's not surprising that the United States Capitol building is the scene of many a ghost story. Clarence Brown, president of the U.S. Capitol Historical Society and a former congressman himself, says over the past two centuries, both the bold and the faint-hearted claim to have seen or heard spirits at the Capitol. There's the story of the demon black cat, reported over the years by more than one guard. There's the sighting of former president-turned-congressman John Quincy Adams, who died near the floor of the old House chamber in 1848. And there are those who smelled baking bread from the Capitol basement long after Union forces ceased using a secret tunnel as a Civil War bakery. Then there's this touch of Nevada story for you that I found particularly fascinating. It comes from a newspaper that you probably don't read that we get in a little town where I live called Pahrump, Nevada. It's a little newspaper called the Gateway Gazette. It's the Thursday, October 28th edition, and the story is by Dave Downing, who is a Gazette staff writer, and it's entitled The Ghosts of the Mizpah Hotel. About 2 months ago, I bellied up to the bar at one of my favorite watering holes, the Mizpah Hotel Casino in Tonopah. My son had come up from Las Vegas to visit, and we were having a late-night drink. It was about 1 in the morning. You see, about 1 in the morning. These are the times, ladies and gentlemen, where these things occur. A fellow, I would guess to be in his 40s, came up from behind us, sat at the bar next to me. I glanced at him, seeing a dozen or two tattoos on his arm, decided to avoid a conversation. I heard him order a beer. When the beer arrived, he upended the bottle, guzzled down a slug. The bottle hit the bar with a whack, and he looked at me and said, "Boy, that's a hell of a hologram they've got in the elevator." "Huh?" "The elevator," he said. "I've never been there before. They've got an incredible hologram in there." "I don't understand," he said. "Oh, I thought you were a local. The Mizpah has a hologram of a beautiful woman dressed in old-fashioned clothing. It's in the elevator, man. It does look real." I told him that I'm a local. I also asked him, there's no hologram in the elevator. He looked at me strangely, drank his beer, and left. A few minutes later, he returned to the bar. He looked upset. "You're right," he exclaimed. "There is nothing in the elevator." He walked back toward the elevator, and I never saw him again. Had the lady in red appeared again? There are many strange tales from the hallowed ween halls of the Mizpah. The most popular tale involves the murder of a pretty young lady on the fifth floor of the hotel. She was a lady of the evening and became involved in a love triangle. That's according to the assistant manager now of the Mizpah, Sue Harmon. She was caught with another man by the man who was madly in love with her. He stabbed her to death. According to Harmon, there have been many sightings of the lady in red. She resides on the fifth floor, but she'll wander all over the hotel. She loves to pull pranks. She's the one that causes the Keno board to light up. Wait till you hear this. Many employees and visitors to the Mizpah claim they've seen the Keno board begin to flash numbers as if a game were in progress. The Keno boards at the Mizpah haven't been connected to an electrical source for years. Many claim she can be heard at night, moaning and walking about the floors. She's been known to carry on a conversation with people. We'll only later find out no one is there. Sharon Mitchell of Round Mountain relates a story about the lady in red that occurred to her son, Stuart, when he was working at the hotel during its reconstruction in the late 70s. Sharon was a dealer and a pit boss for the Mizpah at the time. Two of my sons worked after school at the Mizpah, helping to remove walls and do general construction work. Stuart was 14 or 15 years old at the time. One night, Stuart was unusually quiet on the way home. I asked him if he was feeling okay, but he said something weird had happened during work. Stuart told his mother, "I was working down in the basement tearing out a wall. There was a woman with me. She asked me what I was doing, and I told her I was taking the wall down. She told me she didn't want the wall taken out. I asked her who she was, and she said, 'I live here, and I don't want that wall taken down.'" Stuart went to get his boss. When they returned, the lady was, of course, no longer there. Sharon told her son that it didn't seem much to be upset about. Stuart responded, "But, Mom, it isn't Halloween," but she was dressed in a costume. According to Sharon, her son then described the lady as wearing a long dress with a bustle that looked like turn-of-the-century clothing. He was very upset. Mitchell said she really didn't believe in ghosts, but if they exist anywhere, they're at the Mizpah. Pat Dennis, a former Mizpah waitress, is one who has personally seen the Keno board begin to light up. I don't know if I don't know for a fact that the Keno board isn't connected to an electrical source, so I can't really say that the lady in red is involved. Who knows? Maybe they left a wire or two connected to some source by accident. Dennis says she's heard that the lady in red will steal guests' shoes, but only if the shoes are red. George Tooley, a former slot mechanic for the Mizpah, has seen that board light up, the Keno board. "It would start playing a game. Usually it would happen during the graveyard shift. All of a sudden, the numbers would start lighting up as if a game were being played. You'd get about 20 numbers. They'd stay up for a while, then all go out. It happened 3 times one night." He added that the controls for the Keno board, get this, were removed in 1979 when the hotel underwent reconstruction. "There are no controls for the board," he said. Waitress Linda Evans has had direct experiences with the lady in red. "She's always been kind to me, but she doesn't like men," she said. Evans tells a tale of horror involving her son and grandson. Her son was 26, the grandson 13 at the time. "I was in the employees section resting. I'd had only 2 hours sleep and I was exhausted. My son and grandson arrived and I opened the door for them. They just stood there staring beyond me. They looked as if they were in a trance. I asked them if they were coming in. They just stood and stared. I finally turned around and looked behind me, but I didn't see anything. I turned back to them and my grandson said, 'That's the first time I ever saw a person without a head.'" The boy told her they saw a woman dressed in red walk across the room and through a wall. She was holding her head in her hands. They both said they saw the same thing. He also tells the story of a band that had been contracted by the Mizpah. They heard stories about the lady in red decided to hold a party in their room. During the party, they began asking before her a sort of seance. The lady not only appeared to them, but bothered them for the rest of the week. She wouldn't leave them alone. There are other stories about different ghosts in the Mizpah. Jean Heidman, Mizpah desk clerk, tells about a woman from Las Vegas that had a room on the fifth floor. She woke up and saw a man at the foot of her bed. She began screaming, made quite a bit of racket. Next morning, while she was checking out, she apologized for making such a scene. She explained to me that it was the worst and most realistic nightmare she'd ever had. She went to the Pittman room, that's the Pittman room, for breakfast. She was drinking coffee, glanced at the pictures on the wall. Suddenly she dropped her coffee cup and began screaming again, "That's him! That's the man!" She was looking at a picture of Senator Hee Pittman. According to Jean Bridges, a former waitress, the Mizpah used to have a security guard named Otis. Otis was a huge man that others would be afraid of, big macho type. Bridges and others told how Otis was scared to death of the fifth floor. He would refuse to go up there without someone with him. At some time in his Mizpah career, he had gone to the fifth floor room because of a loud party. And that's where he saw her. And I'm going to stop there. There's more. But that's a little tale of what's going on here in Nevada. And at one of the brothels in Pahrump, Nevada, the locals and everybody there is known for a very long time, there is a ghost. Now, I guess Nevada is a likely candidate for this sort of thing. I don't know why, our history, some of it in the past, violent. And that brings me to why so many ghosts appear, or so many spirits appear to remain here on this world. I think they can't go anywhere else. Frequently, when a death is unexpected, early, violent, when there's something utterly unsatisfied here on earth, unrequited love frequently will bring a spirit that seems to stay. Other reasons. I don't know it all. I just know that I've heard the stories, and this morning you're going to hear them. That's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about ghosts, poltergeists, spirits. And one of the reasons that I've found this topic through my life so fascinating, and I always return to it, is because for a very long time I've been on a search, a hard search, for some sort of proof of life after death. Now, obviously, if spirits are remaining on Earth or here at all, that means there is some sort of life after death. This may be an aberration. It may be, but nevertheless, it certainly is, you must admit, an indication that there is something that comes after. So, if you have a ghost story for us this morning, a real ghost story, if you're seeing a ghost or being bothered by one, now, we want to hear from you. And that's a little taste to get you started. I now await your story, and we'll be right back. All right, if you're ready, I think I am, and if it starts to get scary enough, I will extinguish my lights. And sort of get in the spirit of things. I've done that every year. I'm not allowed to bring a candle in here. No fire. But I do extinguish the lights and kind of get myself into the mood. Here we go. Wild card line 3, good morning. You are on the air.
Thank you, sir. This story revolves around a historical a building in the town of Provincetown, Massachusetts, which is a town that's out on the very tip of Cape Cod. A number of years ago, this is going back about 20 years ago, my uncle was a former California contractor, a builder, who took a job as a caretaker in this building called the Provincetown Inn.
Oh, yes.
And he was there basically living rent-free to do some renovation on this old building.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a guy who watched, you know, the hockey games. It didn't care about ghost stories, didn't believe in that sort of thing. But as he and his wife were living there for a while, they began to see more and more evidence of what I guess you would call poltergeist activity. And this was in the...
pranks, things flying around, that sort
yes,
of thing?
Yes, absolutely. They would be watching a hockey game, and his wife would be cooking some spaghetti sauce in the kitchen, and they'd be watching together. She'd come out, and she'd leave the wooden spoon in the pot, and they'd hear this clatter in the kitchen, and they both run out there, and the spoon would be across the room, and spaghetti sauce would be all over the place. And then they began hearing footsteps in the upper story of the inn at all hours of the day and night, and would rush upstairs to see who was there, because this was generally in the off season when they didn't have any people renting rooms and so forth, and
mm-hmm.
and there was never anyone there. And on one occasion they had some footsteps who were wandering around, and he got his gun off the rack above the hearth, and the stairs were coming down of the wall just on the other side of the living room, and there was a door in the entryway that was at the bottom of the stairs, and this separated the stairwell from where they were watching television. And as the footsteps came down the stair, he said to his wife, as soon as the footsteps get to the bottom, open the door and I'll be ready with the gun.
Mm.
And she opened the door and there was no one there. And so we began hearing stories about this. My family and I lived near Springfield, Massachusetts at the time. And so my brother and I, who were big fans of a television program with Gary Collins, it was called The Sixth Sense or something, that was about the time that this was going on. And we were all hyped up on this paranormal activity. And so we decided we were going to go there with our cameras and try and get pictures of ghosts and this kind of stuff. And we had some really frightening experiences. We began watching my uncle and his wife as they were using a Ouija board, you know, which has the letters of the alphabet and a number of numbers. And
oh, words. I know about Ouija boards.
Yes and no and this kind of thing. And it turned out that leading up to this particular weekend, my brother and I were there, they had actually done some historical research in the archives in Boston and other places to try and find out about the history of the building. And they found, among other things, that in the 1870s, Provincetown had been a big whaling village. There was a lot of whaling going on up and down the eastern seaboard.
Right.
And on one occasion, one of these whaling vessels had run aground on the sandbars off of Provincetown in a major storm, and a number of people had been killed. Well, the lumber that was salvaged from the wreck of the ship was used to build the Provincetown Inn.
Oh, no kidding.
It's annex.
You see, it every time, every one of these stories seems to come back to the same thing. Some sort of violent, unexpected death, or some death that leaves somebody wanting in a terrible moment of love or hate or any giant strong emotion.
Absolutely. In fact, the story goes on. I mean, it gets actually quite a bit more frightening.
All right. Well, listen, we're kind of out of time on this one, but I really do appreciate that. It's right down my alley.
Thank you.
Thank you, my friend. Good morning. East Coast Ghosts. Another place where there are a lot of stories of ghosts and spirits, of course, is New England. Now, I guess you could once again suggest that the older areas, the first settled areas in this country, those up in New England, would be likely settings for such things. And, of course, Europe, where society is quite a bit older than ours, and a lot of buildings are quite a bit older than ours, with a lot of history behind them, seem to be troubled by this sort of thing frequently as well. Again, the reason I find all of this so utterly fascinating is that obviously any proof of ghosts, any confirmation of spirits is, in effect, confirmation of life after death, And I know that many of us, not just me, are totally fascinated by that possibility. So that was a good setup call for what we're going to be doing this morning. I guess you've got the idea. If you've got a story, you know what the numbers are. We'll be back with more.
This is a special replay of Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell. Tonight's program is a rebroadcast from October 30th, 1993. Join Art live Monday night with his annual Ghost to Ghost AM show.
I'm Art Bell. Back to the phones. And good morning, first-time caller line. You're on the air. Where are you calling from?
Good morning. From Alameda, California, right outside of San Francisco.
Oh, excellent. Welcome to the program.
Sorrow. Last year, my five children and I, we live in a big, old, rambling house, and I started hearing things, but I thought it was the children. The house is so big that you might hear from the next room. With five kids, anybody could be anywhere in the house.
Absolutely.
And I'd go, and the door slammed too hard, so I'd go to a reprimand, don't be slamming the door, and there was no one there. So, of course, your mind tells you, I thought I heard something, oh well. And so then you'd hear footsteps, and you think someone's coming downstairs, and you'd go, and, oh, I thought I heard something, oh, well.
Yeah, well, the human mind, of course, reaches out to find rational explanations for things that may not have any rational explanation.
Absolutely, and denial, too.
Sure.
It's called denial. Well, unbeknownst to me, the children were experiencing noises and footsteps, and I didn't want to tell them because I wasn't sure what it was, and I dismissed it from my mind. And then when I started saying, no, this is something, I didn't want to scare them. And apparently they were experiencing all this as well, people going into the shower, someone entering the shower when they were in the shower.
That would bother me.
Oh, that's very unnerving.
Suddenly be in the shower soaping up and feel the brush of another body next to
sensation of something or somebody, and you quickly look out the curtain and no one's there. You quickly lather off and hear it. Say, but I know I did. But here again, I guess it's my mind.
Mm.
Well, everyone was experiencing these things, but no one told anybody. I didn't, for the specific purpose. I didn't want to scare the children. They didn't tell me, thinking, as a child, think that if they told me, it would come true.
Right.
The one day that we found out that everybody knew was when I was reprimanding my son, and he was very distracted and agitated, and I thought he was being disrespectful. So as I started to correct him even more, he finally said, no, Mom, it's not you. I saw something. And that's when the flood of everybody, yes, I saw it too, and I heard this, and saw that, and you would hear someone jumping on the bed, and I'd go to look, and nobody was there. Another night I was home alone, and I was very agitated, and I couldn't read, I couldn't sit down, I couldn't watch TV, and so finally I sat down and looked at a picture book, one of the children's picture books, and I had this overwhelming sense that someone was looking at me.
Mm-hmm.
When they came home, they saw two footprints of mud, and my son put his feet in there, and the angle that it was, whatever it was staring at me. That's why I was so agitated. So these things just started accelerating. When the thing found out that we knew, it started manifesting itself in the form of a shadow, and I'm talking about at 12 noontime. The children saw it first, and they became just crumpled. They were crumpled, absolutely. I mean, they were yelling and screaming. And
I'd be crumpled, too.
And, I mean, I was just, I didn't know what to think. So I called my priest. I went up, and we right away got in the van and went up there and told him, and he didn't believe us. He said there were mice or, you know, people, hysteria, and all the common explanations that you get. I was so upset that on the way home I ran a stop sign. I knew that we saw and we heard what we saw and we heard. Finally, till that night, I saw the shadow. And I bolted up. We were all sleeping now together. We all had to touch each other. Everybody, six people in a room, everybody's feet or something had to be touching. We were so scared.
I do understand, yes.
I didn't want to tell anybody with the reaction of the priest that it wasn't true. I thought we'd be labeled as either liars or...
Did the priest come there?
No, he didn't even want to deal with it. He didn't want to hear about it. I figured out later, like, what could he do? I don't know. I still don't understand why he did not help us.
We're about out of time. How did it become resolved?
We found another priest to come and bless the house. The thing got very agitated. It started throwing things and making noises, and when the priest left, it was still here. We all, my children just became hysterical. I got a crucifix and very corny, I guess, but I went through the house, sending it back to where it came, and it left. But I was still about 2 weeks later now. We're still sleeping together. No one can move. We're paralyzed. No one's eating. No one's going to school. No one's anything. And I'm just saying in my mind, what could it have been? And a voice said, "Your brother." Sure enough, I called around the last known address he was at. No one had seen him in about 15 years. Somehow I was able to track him down in San Francisco. He had died 2 months before.
Oh, my God. Thank you very much for the call. Oh, that sends shivers down my spine. That's the kind of thing that does it, and that's the kind of thing that is so... frequent. When you hear these stories, it comes again and again. Somebody who's passed away. Somebody who's passed away without leaving a message or finishing something that was so important in their life that it couldn't be ignored even in death. Well, let's break for a moment. Good evening. You're on the air.
Oh, yes, Art. I had a brush with something eerie in 1956 in Pittsburgh, PA. As a young couple, my husband and I had moved into the third floor rooms of a very old house, probably built around the turn of the century.
Mm-hmm.
And we rented the third floor rooms. An old couple in their 80s were our landlords on the first floor. The second floor was empty.
Hmm.
And so... among our four rooms, there was one particular small room that for some reason had a very strange, eerie feeling about it. It just never felt right. We just used it for storage and always kept that door closed. So this one particular night, my husband traveled on business and he was away. I came home from work about 6 o'clock. The old couple were in their rooms downstairs but with their doors closed, so I felt very much alone in the house. And I was up there. Our bathroom happened to be on the second floor, which was empty. So I was up there for a couple of hours, and I kept having this terrible feeling that something or someone was in that little room.
Mm-hmm.
And I kept thinking, well, I must be being silly. So after a couple of hours, I went down to use the bathroom on the second floor. And while I'm in there, something seemed to be telling me, do not go back upstairs. And I had to really drag myself up there because I had this horrible feeling. And
You mean you went anyway?
I went anyway.
Well, why do people always do, even in the movies, the woman, scantily dressed women, always go to the basement? Why?
Well, I wasn't scantily dressed.
Well, that's fine.
So anyway, I decided I'm being foolish, so I go up these stairs, and I'm climbing up this very long flight of steps, and I get almost to the top, about the third step down, when I hear the latch of that door open up.
Oh.
It made a click, a loud click, and that door opened and made the biggest squeak you ever heard in your life, just like in the movies. And I raced down those steps back to the bathroom, three at a time, literally, went back in that room, closed the door, locked that bathroom door, and I sat in there for about 2 hours till my husband came home. When I heard that front door downstairs opening, I was so relieved. He came in, and I told him what had happened, so we went back upstairs. And that door was open.
Yes.
About a foot or so. And we looked inside, of course, we saw no one, nothing. And I can't explain why that happened to open that night that way. But in any case, I always, you know, gave me heart failure. But a postscript to all this is that within a year after we had moved out of that house, the old man downstairs in his 80s had died, and a young couple apparently had moved into the second floor, and we read in the paper that their baby had died in its crib.
Oh.
And they were on the second floor. And you know, I just had the strangest feeling that there was a very evil spirit in that house that was looking for a victim or something, and I almost feel that if I had gone up those stairs that night when I heard that door open, that I could have been that victim.
Oh, well, that's...
That was, honest to God, a really spooky house.
I understand, and I heartily appreciate your story.
Okay.
It was a good one. Thank you. That was a good one. Why is it, do you think, that people always compulsively, almost, do what they've been instructed not to do? Why, I joked about, you know, in the horror stories where they always go directly to the basement. It kills me. No, I screamed, no, not the basement. They open the door and down they go, where they're eaten alive by something, inevitably. But even in real life, listen to that lady. Listen to the story we just got. Something told her not to do that, and what's the first thing she did? She forced herself to do it. Maybe the answer is that we want to return to a rational thought pattern. If something disturbs us, we want to deny it. We want a rational explanation for it. So instead of caving into the natural fear of the moment over what just happened, you proceed to try to get a rational, oh, it was the cat, or something like that. You search automatically, or you feel a compulsion to go and search for a rational explanation. That might make sense. Top of the morning on our first-time caller line, you're on the air.
Hi, is this Art?
Yes, it is. Welcome to the program. Where are you, please?
I am in Seattle.
Seattle, Washington, all right.
It's the most livable city in the nation, and I don't care what the people in Cincinnati say. Hey, we're talking about spooky, eerie, weird kind of stuff happening.
That's true.
Well, I have a story for you that probably won't send goosebumps up your spine. It'll probably make you go, oh, isn't that sweet, if that's possible. I had an aunt that I was very, very close to, actually a great aunt, very close to her. She was kind of, I just always kind of looked up to her in life. She was kind of my...
Sure, mentor.
My mentor, thanks. And I had gone out to the cemetery, as I do once a month, to put flowers on her grave and kind of trim the grass and all that.
Right.
And as I was driving around the curve, you have to go downhill and around the curve to get out of the cemetery, she ran out in front of my car, and I thought, no, I'm seeing things, but when somebody runs out in front of your car, what do? You
slam on the brakes.
I got rear-ended by two other cars, one of them being the security guard at the cemetery. I jumped out of the car thinking, oh my God, I'm going to pay for this one through the nose. Went back to make sure the people in the other two cars were okay, and both of them said, well, that woman shouldn't have run out in front of you like that. And I said, well, you saw her too? And they said, of course we saw her. And I said, well, I don't really remember what she looked like. I knew what she looked like, but, you know, I wanted to check things out.
Now, when you went around to check the front of your car, there was, I take it, no woman.
There was no dent. I mean, I didn't hit her. She just kind of ran out in front of the car, across the street, and up this hill towards where there's kind of some woods. And everybody, there was a family in the car behind me and the security guard, all saw exactly the same person. A year after that, I went to the cemetery, drove down the hill, went around the corner, and the same exact thing happened again. And I was rear-ended.
You're wrong. This
another
is,
car.
You're wrong, sir. This is a goosebump story.
They saw the same person. And I guess the point that I'm getting at is I see my aunt all the time. I see her when I'm in town. I don't know if it's somebody that looks like her. But I just feel that she has a lot to do with the things that have been happening in my life. I feel like she's always guiding me.
Yeah, do you tend to see her at critical junctures in your life?
You know, that's funny you should say that. A month ago, I was in the hospital facing major surgery, and the door opened one night, and she came in and sat on the bed, took my hand, and said, "The doctors are wrong. They've misdiagnosed you. You need to tell them that." The next morning, I asked the doctor to rerun tests because I felt something wasn't right, and sure enough, the tests had come out wrong, and I didn't need surgery.
So, oh, man. All right, sir, I've got to run. We're out of time, but believe me, that's a prime.
You're a lot. She's there, and she's taking care of me, so I have a good guardian angel.
Thank you for the call. My gosh, what a story. Didn't mean to cut you off, but we're out of time, and I think we got the substance of your story. And believe me, sir, you're wrong. That's a big goosebump story. Big goosebump story. That's incredible. Of course, it might be some evidence that there are spirits of all temperaments. In other words, spirits not only that that are evil, spirits that are helpful or loving may be there as well. Spirits of all kinds, kind of like a cross-section of the people that we've got on the planet right now, eh? Good morning. Line 2, you're on the air.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning.
I wanted to tell you something that you just keyed my mind after listening to everyone else.
Well, these have already been some pretty good stories, haven't they?
Yes, they have. In 1955, we had moved from Ely, Nevada, which is a very famous mining town, et cetera, a very old town. And we had moved over to Provo, Utah in 1953. And in 1955, on December 18th, I woke up with a terrible dream that someone in the family had died. And I didn't know who it was. And I immediately keyed on to my cousin, who was still residing in the same town in Ely. And so I called her that night, and I asked her how everything was going and everything. And they, you know, there were three kids in the family then, or four kids in the family then, and her mother was pregnant with number 5. And she said, "Well, everything's fine, you know." And I said, "Well, I was going to call and wish a Merry Christmas." And on December 21st, I woke up, and it was some ridiculous hour, like 12:30 or something, and I'm in school, and I'm a young person. And I said, "Somebody's gone." And I laid awake and waited for the phone to ring, and it rang, and it was my cousin's uncle had died in a car accident. And I thought, oh wow, this is pretty weird, you know. And then I had been experiencing other things throughout my life, and during 1970 I was visited in my mirror by my father, my biological father, who I did not know was deceased.
That would scare me to death. That might scare me to death. To look in a mirror, I hear stories like these, ma'am, and that would really frighten me. How solid did the vision seem to be?
Well, the first thing was, it was a new home. Well, it was new to me and my husband, and, of course, my first child was born while we were there, and I was pregnant with my second child. And we had just bought this new bedroom set and set it up and everything. And my husband was away a lot. He was active in mining and stuff. And all of a sudden, just out of a clear blue sky, I woke up and I saw this strange light. It was like light in the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
And it got brighter and brighter and brighter. And I got scared. I really did.
I understand.
And all of a sudden, it came out of the mirror, and there was my biological father. I had not seen him since I was
old. Wait a minute. It came out of the mirror?
Out of the mirror.
In a solid form?
In a solid form. And it was my biological father, and I had never seen him since I was 3 years old.
And you had a conversation with this man?
Yes, I did. And what he said not to be afraid. And he said, "Kiss the children for me." And it brought tears to my eyes. I was so frightened, and yet I was at peace. It was just amazing.
Believe me, I understand that cross of emotions. I have got to go. Thank you so much for the story. Did you hear her voice at the end? Did you hear that? Do you believe that, lady? I do. Do you believe these stories? I do. Do you understand what it means? I think I do. Is there life after this one? I think there is. Are these things we don't understand? They certainly are. Are they a little frightening? They absolutely are. All I can conclude so far is that in the matter of somebody's death, which is violent or is unexpected, or in the manner of somebody who dies and has something that they must do, something they didn't finish, somebody they didn't say goodbye to, somebody they wanted to tell that they loved before they left and didn't get a chance to, children that are left behind that you wanted to be sure understood that you loved them, because what could be more important at that time? Really nothing. Does all this add up to life after death? I think that it does. That's why we do these programs. Good morning, everybody. You're listening to Coast AM from Las Vegas. Exploring areas that some would say we ought not. Ghosts, the paranormal, things that people have seen and heard. If you'd like to be part of it, pick up the telephone and join in. You're back on the air, sir.
Thank you, Art. As I was saying, this house out in Lynnwood, after all this activity started taking place in the house, I haven't had any sightings. You don't have to see something to be haunted. A lot of poltergeist activity, they don't see things. Mm-hmm. But electrical sockets burning out, doors getting slammed. Her father came out to the house. He is in construction, a contractor. Did some work on the sockets, and toasters would plug in, and then they'd burn out. One day, a woman friend of hers came over to pay her a visit. Comes into the house, has a small 3 or 4 year old child. The child says he sees a lady in the hallway.
Oh.
A little while later, he's playing in the hallway, door slams shut. The woman, the mother of the child, and the woman who owns the house, it takes them 20 minutes to get the door unstuck, at which point the mother becomes hysterical. The little kid is scared because the lady was, he had felt or thought he had seen the lady there. They finally did get the door unstuck. There was no reason for the door being stuck. Mother and child left the house, haven't been back since. Theory. You were talking about how a lot of these people get separated from their bodies. The Indians and a lot of people believe that people who are addicted to drugs or drink alcohol get separated from their spirit.
I've heard that.
Now, if somebody gets separated from their spirit because of drug abuse, or they weren't ready to leave because they've died a violent death, then I think if they don't, if there's that separation of body and spirit like that, or the Indians say it'll punch, drugs and alcohol will punch holes in your spirit. If you beat your spirit up or yourself up, you may wind up being grounded here.
Well, that would seem to happen, wouldn't it? I mean, story after story after story.
And like I say, they looked into it, and they had found out that, yes, a woman had died there years earlier. And then later on, they looked into it and discovered that, well, the cause of death was a heroin overdose. And this is one very angry spirit. Some people get in that house, and they're fine. Some people go in there and they aren't fine.
Well, if it does punch holes in the spirit, that's a big hole.
Yeah, they tried to get my girlfriend to babysit out there, house sit rather, and when she found out about the house, she didn't want to go. And so there's some sensible information for your listeners, too.
I appreciate it. I appreciate it, sir, and I appreciate the call. Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Right, bye. You know, you ask yourself that question, would you go into a haunted house if you knew it was haunted, if the story was that it was haunted? And there were spirits lingering there.
Would you go in?
Top of the morning, you're on the air, coast to coast, AM with Art Bell. Where are you calling from, please?
Hi, Art. Salt Lake City.
Salt Lake City, yes.
Listen, sir, I'd like to interject a note of caution from the cultural mecca of all that is the United States. First of all, if also before I can, with the death of Vincent Price, I want to say you made it into my top four American heroes, sir.
Oh, well, thank you.
All right. Anyway, listen, I had an experience with a Ouija board, and just a note that the, you know, biblically, I don't know how you feel about Christianity. But the scriptures do tell us that that ghosts, you know, the spirits of the dead do not come back to haunt the living. In fact, they're demons taking manifestations in order to fool the relatives of those that have already passed on. So
how then, if that's the case, do you account for some of the stories like we've heard this morning, the lady with the car and no brakes, spirits that seem to be those of departed loved ones that are here to help?
Well, a lot of times, you know, you don't have the full stories. A lot of these spirits may be, you know, intending to appear as benevolent, when in fact the intentions may be very malign. I that's not what I wanted to talk about. I want to give you my own experience very quickly.
Sure.
What I was doing is I was playing with a Ouija board alone, long, long time ago.
Bad idea.
And I began having an argument with the planchette. Well, you know, I thought, oh, this is nonsense. This is my own energy, and, you know, there's nothing in this. And at one point, every time that I would push the planchette to the S, the phone would ring. And so I asked the board if it were in fact ringing the phone, and it moves to the yes position. Well, I ran across the room to answer the phone. The phone kept ringing, and there was it was a crackling line. It sounded, the voice was distant, miles away,
yes.
Ancient voice, and it says, "You shall," and I didn't have the guts to listen to it. I hung the phone up. And, for the next 7 years, this phenomena have been happening in my life. For example, I'll pass by cars.
Haven't you forevermore, if I can stop you, wondered, you shall what?
I don't know.
How could you hang up?
I really did not want to know. I didn't want to hear what it was going to say.
Okay.
But it is a warning. Don't, you know, I've had an aversion to the paraphernalia of the occult ever since. And I think, you know, there is...
I have a lot of respect for Ouija boards. I've had an experience with one myself, and I won't even talk about it.
Well, as I said, it may answer your question of whether or not you would spin around and see what it was there that was manifesting itself or going to a haunted house. I've done it since the experience, but in every case, I've rooted.
I appreciate your call, sir.
Certainly. Have a good morning.
All right. That's Salt Lake City with a caution, and a well-given caution it was, too, I might add. Well, given caution, you be careful. There are lots of things out there that we don't understand. And I think the possibility exists that a Ouija board is just inviting trouble. Line 3, you're on the air.
Hi, Art. How are you doing?
Fine, sir. Welcome to the program.
Real good show tonight.
Thank you.
Say, I have a question. That caller that called last hour about the glowing gravestone?
Yes.
There's a phenomenon called St. Elmo's Fire.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But St. Elmo's Fire tends not to return predictably to the same place again and again.
Yeah. During a...
Not saying it wasn't. I'm just saying that on many occasions the caller said he saw this glowing gravestone and that it would be St. Elmo's Fire... That many times is not probable.
That's true, but that'd be something you really would want to see once, and I think that'd be about it.
That'd do me.
Yeah. Well, take it easy.
All right. Thank you. Just wanted to suggest that possibility. I guess. Hi, on the first time caller line, you're on the air.
Yeah. Hi.
Where are you, sir?
I'm in Alaska.
Alaska. All right.
I was in the United States Marine Corps, and I was a sniper. And I was I went to Grenada, and I got hit in the knee with a bullet. And from pictures in the family, it was my great great grandfather in a Civil War uniform that sat down and froze my leg. And the Grenada is a jungle, and he said, "Everything will be okay, boy. Everything will be okay." And this first time I've talked about it, other than to the military psychologist, and...
All right, if you don't mind, I want to be sure I understand. You were part of the invasion force. You were a sniper. You were in Grenada.
Yeah, my job, my job was to make sure nobody, none of the Cubans, got into the students at the university.
Uh-huh. And so you were stationed there, and you were just going to take them out if you had to.
Yes.
And
an anti-sniper got me. My A-gunner ended up getting him.
Hit you in the leg?
Yeah, in the knee.
In the, oh, God.
Well, it went from the knee, at the end of my military career, went from the knee up around the pelvis bone and out the other ankle. The bullet traveled my whole, all.
What a horrible injury.
Yeah, it hurt. Very much so.
And so you were laying there.
Yeah, I all instantly fell. There was nothing I could do. And like I say, through pictures of the family photo album, it was my, I think it'd be three great, he was in the Civil War, and it'd be three great grandfathers sat down and froze my leg. There, my leg was frozen, not cauterized, it was frozen.
Frozen.
The whole wound, which is something nobody's been able to explain. And he said, everything will be okay now, boy. Everything will be okay.
And left?
Yeah.
That's eerie. What did the medics say?
Medics, they were just asking me what we'd done, how we'd done this, where did we get ice. Nobody could understand. The psychologist told me that it was in the lust of battle and that I'd lost a lot of blood and that I wasn't sure what was happening. But my spotter, who was also a sniper, he felt something cold as he was taking the other man out, and he has shot before. It wasn't, you know, it's not the coldness you feel when you take a man out.
I understand.
It was completely different, and, you know, I was scared, but at the same time, there was this great feeling of security and just the joy of knowing that I had a family member there. Because I really thought that I'd, you know, the pain that I was feeling, I knew where I was, I knew where the bullet went out. I didn't know what the damages were.
That's the most incredible story I've ever heard, and I really appreciate your call, sir. Thank you. Wow. For that one, I'll take a quick break. We'll be right back. Good morning. You're on the air. Coast would have been. You were a dial tone. Spirit of a dial tone. Wildcard line 3, you're on the air.
Hello, Art.
Hello.
Yes, I have a... This is Mark from Anderson, California.
Hi, Mark.
Yeah, I had a situation that happened a couple years ago. I was sitting at a friend's house, and it was about 1 o'clock in the morning. And we were sitting there talking about, you know, people that we've known throughout our lives. And I was sitting in a chair, and all of a sudden, I bent over in extreme pain. I mean, it took me to the floor, out of the chair onto the floor on my right side. And then I kind of got a headache, and we were just, for some reason, my friend Craig and I both noted the time.
Right.
The thing that was strange was the next day, my friend was looking through the paper and noticed that a friend of mine had been killed. I used to work at a convenience store, and she used to come in, and her parents didn't really listen to her, and I was kind of like her mentor. I was her sounding board, you know, whenever she had problems.
Mm-hmm.
And he told me that this young lady named Kelly had died. And I knew the area where she had been hit by a car. I knew that much. And I went out into the area, and I was just kind of walking around. By feel, I found the area where she was hit, just through whatever I have in myself that told me this is it.
You just knew it.
I just knew it, and we were kind of kicking around, and we saw one of the sheriff's deputies' car go up there, and I went and flagged him down and asked him if he had been working the night she got killed.
Mm-hmm.
And he said yes, and I told him that she was a friend of mine, and I said to him, I know this is going to sound morbid, but what side of her body did the truck impact her on? He told me that the initial strike hit her on the right side, fracturing her pelvis. She flipped up over the truck and landed on her head and was killed immediately.
Mm.
Now, this was within 5 minutes. This was the night before that I fell over. This was in 5 minutes of that time that the time of death was pronounced. And my belief is that she said, came to me and said goodbye. And it was just too weird. And a friend of mine if you'd like, he was there. I told him if he would like, he could call back and verify, because he was there. And he was kind of freaked out as the couple days where we talked to the sheriff's deputy and stuff.
I'm just convinced it happens. People come back. People do come back, and they do say goodbye.
My friend and I are researching a book on, we're going to be writing a book basically on poltergeists and demonology. And I was wondering if either I could give you an address that people could write letters to, because we're looking for input, or if you'd prefer that I mailed it to you.
Well, if I were you, I would roll a tape on this program.
Okay, well, I realize.
All right. Otherwise, I'll see what I can do.
Okay.
All right, thank you. You might want to, you really might want to get a copy of this program. Because these are some of the most serious stories that I've ever heard. And I don't know where you could go to get a better rendition of stuff that'll just put the hackles right down your back. This is pretty good this morning. Good morning. On our first-time caller line, you're on the air. Where are you, please?
I'm calling from Denver.
Welcome to the program.
Thank you. Art, I want to tell you that Ouija board, if you mess with that, it happened to me when I was 9 years old. It's an entrance for a satanic spirit to enter your body. And Dr. Ken Olson, who was on the Maury Povich show...
Maury Povich.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Thank you. He was the person that released that terrible demonic spirit. And it happened to me when I was 9 through age 54, the worst type of satanic deprivation that could ever enter a human body. And I'm telling you, leave it alone. Don't allow anyone to touch or be around or play around with a Ouija board. Because if you don't have someone like Dr. Ken Olson, who is an exorcist, a vessel of Jesus Christ, he is an instrument of God, to pray to release that, it can cause the worst type of nightmares that you could ever have, and the worst type of life that you could ever have. And I want to tell you the truth, and your listeners, to never be around a Ouija board or allow any type of activity.
Well, I'm glad you gave everybody else the caution. I don't need it. Believe me, I've got that caution. Thank you for the call. That's Denver. And heed what that man says. Ouija boards are bizarre things that do seem to, you know, hate to use the word door, open the door, but open a channel, open a conduit for things that you really don't want around you. Line 3, you're on the air. Good morning.
Okay, I'm calling from Reno.
Reno, oh, KOH, yes.
And this concerns the old mining camp of Virginia City, where the big mines, excuse me, the big mines been abandoned for many years, but there are 700 miles of shafts and tunnels and drifts and windows underground.
Yes, sir.
200 miles in a big labyrinth. And I was having lunch with my parents in Virginia City, and knocking at the back door, and there came an old friend of my dad's, very agitated, a big lump in his forehead, and it was split, his cuts, and the blood was coming down, so folks patched him up, and he, like many of the old retired miners, he liked to roam through the abandoned mines, take samples out and stuff like that, and he was in the mine called the Ward Mine, southeast of Virginia City.
Is that W-A-R-D, Ward?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And I think I guess he had his carbide lamp in his hat. And he turned the corner and came down a corridor. There, you know, kind of illuminated, was a man buried up over, almost to his head in cave-in dirt. His arms were free, and he was shaking them and waving his head back and forth. He face was contorted, and obviously a cave in there. Our friend was so startled that he turned around and started to run. He timber over the top, over the roof of the mine, and he ran into it. That's where he got that knock on the head. Well, when he told the story around town, people just laughed and said, well, he must have bumped his head first and had a...
Yeah, sure, sure.
Several years later, some mining engineers were looking at the maps of the old mines, and they were examining the ward, and it has all the details. And he said, my goodness, there was a fatal cave-in in the tunnel number so-and-so. And that was the one.
That is really eerie.
True.
That's really eerie. I understand, sir. I understand. I really thank you for the call.
Okay, Art.
And so there you go. There is a mining story. A man buried almost to his head who had died violently and quickly and unexpectedly. The worrisome part, of course, of that is, if that is to be the manner of your death or mine, would we be forever trapped here on Earth in such a destined to repeat such a gruesome experience again and again, though it wasn't something that was from some deviant behavior that we had exhibited, but simply the unlucky moment of a mine caving in on us. Line one, you're on the air.
Morning, Art. I thought I'd give you a call. Been listening to these programs. I'll give you an experience. A couple of years ago, coming in on 163, I was approaching Level Canyon turnoff. And you know where the old Christmas tree used to be?
Yes.
Okay, it was right after that fire. It was lightning, and we were joking around as we were driving, and I said, you know, and defiantly, like, just show me that you're out there. And a couple times the lightning struck, and so finally again I said, you know.
Just show me that you're out there, meaning God?
Well, a superior being, yeah.
Oh,
God, who knows?
Listen, would you hold through my break? It's a good place to break it anyway.
Okay.
All right. Show me you're out there. Prove it to me. If you've got the guts, turn off the lights, turn your radio on, and join us. This is Coast to Coast AM. I'm Art Bell. Back now to line one. You're back on the air again, sir.
Okay, thank you. Well, anyway, to make a long story short, we were just joking around, and again, like I said, it's sort of like a challenge, you know, make me a believer. And about that time, literally, two bolts of lightning came right across the front of the truck and hit the side of the road about, oh, maybe 400 yards up from where we were traveling. And it was just like out of a Star Wars. I mean, it was one bolt from one side of the car and one from the other. And we pulled over and sat there for about 5 minutes and drove on up to Mountain Pass. And like I said...
Tell me something. Had you said this mentally, crying out, or had you said it aloud?
We were talking about... And in the conversation, I said it out loud. I told him, I said, Bill, I said, you know, just show me out there, God. If you're out there, make me a believer. And, you know, a couple strikes around us. But then, you know, well, that was close. Give me another sign. Make sure that you can hear me, you know.
Well, I'm glad you didn't ask for absolute proof.
Well, tell you what, I've never asked for something again that I didn't want.
Oh, man, what a story. Now, how has this affected you, and how has it affected Bill?
Well, we talk about it occasionally, and like I said, we just look at each other and shake our heads. And like I said, to me, it's a thing in life now. I don't ask for anything that, you know, in a joking manner anymore.
It's been said, be careful what you wish for.
Yeah, it might come true.
Thank you for the story. Take care. That's that was quite a story. That's a local story, too. That's a road I travel every day. And it's a dark road. And it's a dangerous road that I travel, Highway 160. I do about 120 miles a day on it. There have been a lot of people killed. there are a lot of crosses placed on the roadside to designate the place where it's occurred. I've never seen anything. Not yet. Good morning. On the first time caller line, you're on the air.
Hi, I'm calling from Genoa, Nevada.
Where in Nevada?
Genoa.
Genoa, Nevada.
Oh, Genoa.
Where is that?
It is just about 10 miles south of Carson City. It's the first Nevada settlement.
Very good.
And anyway, I was, this was about 2 years ago, my story. I'm a recovering alcoholic, and I was going out with a girl who had just got into recovery, and we were in counseling, and we were doing a bunch of inner child work. And, you know, one of the reasons we got along so well, our therapist says, because we played so well together. Well, this whole relationship went sour, and she began dating this other man, and they were going to move to Cleveland, Ohio. And anyway, so one night, I'm laying in my bed, and this therapy work that we're doing with inner child, you have to close your eyes and imagine this child and you know, what that child was doing at the time. And I was laying in my bed, and my eyes were open, and all of a sudden, this little girl, about 8 years old, she had a pixie haircut and kind of a, she was wearing shorts and a small halter top, came up, and she was standing right next to my bed, and my eyes were wide open. And it was that my girlfriend is like, you know, a smaller version of her, right? And
yes.
And this girl, without opening her lips or anything, said, you know, to me, "I've come to play with Chris," who was like, and that's my name and my inner child. So this little girl is standing there, and she's talking to me. She says, "And I'm leaving. I'm moving. And I wanted to come and play." And so she starts taking off with this other little kid. I'm assuming it was me. And they're running. And all of a sudden, then I don't see walls in my room or anything. I just see them out like in a field running.
Wow.
And I keep saying out loud to this girl who I had since not dated, "Gary, do you feel this?" I was wondering if there was a connection between her and me.
Right.
And I kept saying, do you feel this? Are you here? Do you, you know, are you seeing what I'm seeing?" And then after they got done playing, this went on for, I'm going to guess, 10 minutes. And then the little girl walked back up and said thank you and that she was leaving and that, you know, hopefully she would come back to see us again. And I had told her, I mean, I'm talking directly to this. She was transparent, but she was still standing right there. And I was telling her, I said, "You can come back anytime you want." It was not a fear thing. I was not afraid.
Why not?
Well, because she was...
I guess because it was somebody you knew, somebody you know.
Right, I think so. And she was just, you know, 8 years old, 9 years old, and just real shy, and you know...
I would like to think I could react as you did. I'm going to have to leave the line because we're out of time. I thank you for the call. I would like to think that I would react that way. And maybe, if it was somebody that I had known, somebody that I was comfortable with, and the experience felt benign, maybe I would be. But I'm not sure of that. Line two, you're on the air.
Hi, Art.
Hello.
Hello, in Las Vegas.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to relate an experience I had, but first I'd like to see if I can jog your memory. The last time I called in was a year or so ago, and you had put out a question over the air, and I think it's somewhat apropos of tonight also. The question that you put out was that night was, what do you think the purpose of life is?
That's right.
And my call to you was a story that was related to me, and I told you at the time I wasn't sure I believed or accepted it. Is that we were, this is where I want to see if I can jog your memory. We were all gods and goddesses, and we had everything and could do everything, and so we decided to play a game, and the game was called Life, and part of the rules of the game.
I remember.
Yeah, okay.
You're right. The question and tonight's topic go together very well. Go ahead now.
some years ago, in the late 60s, I was living in Los Angeles, and I made a couple of acquaintances. They had a small business going. One was a writer, the other was a printer, an artist, and they had made up copies of a poster that they came up with. And in our dealings, they asked that I would I sell the poster for them. I agreed to, and for a while I sold it around the Los Angeles area to bookstores and so on. And then they suggested, why don't you make a trip to the Bay Area, to San Francisco, and see how it'll go up there. It was during the time of the Haight-Ashbury things, during the hippie days.
Oh, I remember the time.
Uh-huh. And so I agreed to make the trip, and I went up there, and the evening that I arrived in San Francisco, before I decided to get a hotel room, I decided to eat in a restaurant, and then after that I went to a piano bar. I thought I'd just kind of rest for a while and listen to some music, and a fellow sitting next to me at the piano bar and I got to talking, and I let him know that I was up from L.A., and he said, well, you don't have to get a hotel room. There's a house that I know of that isn't being occupied right now, and I've got the key, and you're welcome to use it. I went to the house, and it was on a street of the old Victorian homes that are so frequent in San Francisco. This was about the middle of the block, and it was the only one in the whole row of Victorian homes on that block that was set in from the others. I thought that was interesting. I went up the porch and unlocked the door and turned on the light and went inside.
Right.
But as I entered, I got a very uneasy feeling in my gut. And as I got further into the place, into the house, that feeling got stronger. And I just figured, oh, well.
Uneasy as in you shouldn't be there?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, listen, we're short on time, so.
Oh, I wanted to get the story out. Anyway, so I walked into the kitchen, and which was all the way in the back, and there were multi-windows, and a window door, and I opened the door and was going to step out, and I paused, and I looked down, and there were no stairs, and it was about 10 feet straight down. I then proceeded into the living room, and I've got a much more uneasy feeling.
We're about to run out of time.
I went up the stairs slowly, and I got to the head of the stairs. There were two bedrooms. I could not enter either of the bedrooms. I just had to leave. It became unbearable to be there, even though my mind was saying, there's nothing wrong here, there's nothing wrong here. I just couldn't stay. It was extremely uncomfortable.
All right, we're going to have to hold it there. Thank you very much for the call, and good morning. Have you ever had that happen? Something inside of you so strongly compelling you to leave, telling you that something is urgently, terribly, profoundly wrong. Good morning. First time caller line, you're on the air.
Good morning, Art Bell.
Yes, where are you calling from?
This is Pavo.
Pavo in Canada. Yes, you have something that relates to all this, Pavo?
Yes, I do.
That's amazing. All right, let's hear it.
Usually, people that enter into my domain receive an eerie feeling when they see all of the murals and...
I can only imagine what your area looks like, Bob.
But there's one room in my house that is a shrine to you-know-who.
Hitler.
Yes. And when you walk in, the presence is so strong that the power... You feel the power.
Thank you, Pavo. That is Pavo, who is in Canada. He's up in the Edmonton area, I believe. And Pavo is a Nazi. And he really is a Nazi. And he was talking about what he does now. And his shrine, I don't have to be there to imagine what it is like. And I can easily imagine that it imparts the exact feeling that he was just talking about. Eerie. Wildcard Line 3, you're on the air. Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Bell, calling from Albuquerque.
Albuquerque, yes, sir.
Just a real quick story, not quite as heavy as most of them, but I guess I was about 2 years old when my father told me about this. I had a favorite uncle, and I I can't really remember his name right now because, again, I was 2 years old, but well, let's call him Uncle Joe. So I guess out of the clear blue sky one day, I wanted to go see Uncle Joe, and they said, no, no, it's too far away. It's about a 100-mile drive or something. And this was back in the 50s, and I guess I had a fit, according to my father, and I just had to go see Uncle Joe, you know. So they decided that weekend to go see Uncle Joe, so we went up there and had a nice visit, and then a couple weeks later, he died, you know. So then, you know, this a short time later, say a couple months later, I wanted to go see another relative. And of course, they didn't die, but my dad said they just about went crazy because they were afraid that something was going to go wrong with this relative.
In other words, they figured that you had some precognitive.
Yeah, they said after the first time, they figured they were afraid of looking up anybody's name, so. It's just a short little story.
Oh, I appreciate it.
Get off the air because you get a lot of good stories. I don't want to.
Yeah, they've been some. There really have been some tremendous.
Excellent stories. Show.
Thank you. Yeah, I want to go see Uncle So and So. Quickly call him, tell him to stay in bed today. I don't think it works like that, though. Do you? I think that things that are going to happen happen. Don't you? Or do you think that that with the help of somebody who's been around before, some things that might happen otherwise would not, or can be avoided, like the lady with the story about the brakes? Line 3, you're on the air. Hello, line 3. No, you're not. Wild card, line 3, you're on the air.
Card?
Yes.
I'm calling from Anchorage, Alaska.
Welcome to the program.
All right. I was wanting to tell you a little story here that happened to me about 3 years ago.
All right. Go right ahead.
All right. I was staying with some friends, and my mom lives up here in Anchorage, or in King Salmon, and she was telling me that she had a bad dream or whatever about me getting in a wreck over the weekend. And I was like, well, you know, just you know, shrugged it off or whatever, didn't think about it. And sure enough, the weekend came around, and I got in a really serious motorcycle wreck.
Oh.
And was in the hospital for a long time and everything, and she was in the hospital, and she was like, you know, she just couldn't believe that it actually happened or whatever, and she was sitting there trying to explain to me what really had went on that night that she had the bad dream, and she said that someone had actually came to her that night while she was asleep or whatever and woke her up. She didn't know who it was, no face or nothing, or any kind of, and told my mother that I was going to die at the end of the week.
Really?
And she told me I was just supposed to get in a wreck or whatever, just try to be careful. And she didn't tell me I was going to die. She just told me I was going to get in a wreck. And she was like, tell me what.
Why, if she would tell you that, I'm curious, if she would tell you, be careful or you're going to be in a wreck, and she would go to all that trouble to caution you about that, why wouldn't she give you the original message and try to warn you away or try to change what was to be?
I really don't know. I'm just assuming she didn't probably want to worry me or scare me or whatever, because she's had these, I'm not saying she's psychic or nothing, but she's done the same thing to her real father. Her real father was really deadly sick down in Florida, and no one knew anything about her, so she called down and talked to one of her sisters to go tell him to check on him, and sure enough, they went to check him out and everything, and he was, they found him on the floor, you know, and he was not in the greatest health or whatever, and it's just been a couple of weird coincidences or just something that's she's definitely got some sort of weird power, not power, but just some sort of gift, I guess, or something.
I take it any similar caution given now, you would really...
Most definitely, yeah.
All right. Thank you very much for the call.
All right.
You take care from the state of Alaska. Line 1, you're on the air.
Oh, it's me?
It's you.
Oh, hi. My name's Don. I'm a first-time caller.
Hi, Don.
And I'm coming from Vegas. I used to live out there in Pahrump, and I have quick stories, and both of them happened while I was living out there.
All right. Go right ahead. It is a strange place.
Yeah. Well, one of them, the first one is I was dating this girl in St. George, and I happened to be there late for one weekend, and I had to be back in Pahrump for a for work the next morning, but I was there too late, so I stayed the night at her house in their guest bedroom. And I had already gone to sleep. You know, the doors were shut and the lights were off and everything.
Right.
And for some reason, I woke up and I looked towards the door, and I could see, I don't know, three, four, or five people looking in at me. So I rubbed my eyes because I thought, you know, I was seeing something. And after I rubbed my eyes, I saw someone standing next to me in the bed.
Hmm.
And you know how you can see, even though it's dark, you can still kind of see him.
Yes.
He had, I could tell he was blonde. And I was about to say something to him, ask him what he's doing, because it didn't appear to me that he might be a spirit.
Yes.
And just before I started to talk, he proceeded to fall on top of me, and I jumped back, and...
So you felt the physical presence?
No, I didn't feel it. I jumped back because I thought someone was going to fall on top of me, and as soon as he was about to fall on top of me, he disappeared.
And that was in Pahrump?
No, that was in St. George.
All right, and now you've got a story about Pahrump.
Yeah, I used to play football out there in Pahrump. I graduated in 82. I think I was a junior at the time.
All right, listen. Hold on. I'm going to put you on hold. I'm going to do a newscast, and I'm going to come right back to you.
Okay.
All right, stay right there. And he's got a story about my hometown, Little Pahrump, Nevada, which I'm sure in large numbers is listening this morning. So all of you out in Pahrump, get ready, because here comes a story that comes from right there in town. It is a very odd place, and in Pahrump, Nevada, which is Nye County, there are brothels, for it is a legal business there. And in one of those brothels, there has for years and years and years been a ghost named Harold. We'll be back.
Replay of Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell. This program originally aired October 30th, 1993. Please do not call.
Once again, here I am. Hi, everybody. What a program this morning, huh? And it's all you. Thank you very much for a very, 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 very unnerving, entertaining, provoking evening. We're telling ghost stories, real ghost stories. If you have one, feel free to join us. If you don't, sit back and listen. Turn out the lights if you dare, and the radio up. And you may well may want to tell us as the morning wears on how you're doing. Line one, you're back on the air again.
Okay.
And now, Pahrump, Nevada.
Yeah. I was playing football for him, and I think I was a junior, and we had an away game. So I was on the varsity bus, and my sister was on the junior varsity bus. And for some reason, the junior varsity bus got way behind us. And so we showed up at the high school, and I had the car with me. And so I decided to just stay there and wait for my sister with the car. And after everybody had left, I got in the car, and I laid the seat back just to go to sleep. And then next thing I noticed, the bus, the JV bus came, and I could see people walking out. I could hear the voices. I recognized the voices. Then I woke up and looked out, and nothing was there. I didn't think much of it because, you know, I just thought, oh, I'm just dreaming.
Dreaming, yeah.
I went back to sleep, and I saw the exact same thing again. I saw the bus. Saw the people getting out of the bus, heard the voices, but this time I knew I was dreaming, and I tried to wake up, and I had a hard time. But finally, I woke myself up, looked out, and there was nothing there. So then I decided to go back to sleep. You know, that was a little scary, but I went back to sleep, and I saw the exact same thing, only this time I saw my sister walk up to the side of the car. She had one of her friends with her, and she was asking to be let in. And this time, and I knew I was dreaming again, but this time I had a real hard time waking up. And finally I had to scream just to wake up. And that time I decided I'm getting out of here. And so I just went home and decided to wait for the phone call at home. And I've grown up in the country, so, you know, being out in the country alone at night never really bothered me, but this really did.
I understand. I think it odd that you knew you were in a dream. I've never had that experience. My dreams have always been as reality until I woke up and knew. You know, when you wake up, you know you had a dream, right?
Uh-huh.
But I've never known in a dream that I was dreaming. That's odd.
And I lived about a half a mile from one of those houses of ill repute that you talk about. So you know how far I had to drive home from high school.
I do. I thank you for the call.
All right, thanks.
And, yes, indeed. I know the area. Good morning on our... you would have been. Wildcard Line 3, instead you're on the air. Hello.
Hello, Art. I have a little story. This goes back to... the early 70s.
Where are you?
I'm calling from Linwood, Washington.
All right.
AVI. The name's
yes.
Tom. I was traveling across Nevada from Idaho down to California, and it was early in the morning, and I was outside of Winnemucca about 5:30 or 6 o'clock, and I was by myself, and I'm out of breath. Okay. As I was driving along, it was out in the desert area, and there was absolutely virtually uninhabited.
Right.
And a car came up behind me with two inhabitants who they started following right on my bumper. And I became concerned because it became apparent that they were really interested in getting me stopped. And they would pull up alongside and motion me over and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was afraid that... you know, I was afraid they were going to
assault you, rob you, whatever.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, sure, that'd be natural.
So, as we went along, this played out for several miles, and they kept motioning for me to pull over, and they come up alongside, and I became quite fearful. Well, the oddest thing happened. I had a flat tire. And I could feel the car start to sway.
Sure.
And I pulled up to a stop, and off to the right was a house. And this car pulled up along and stopped behind me, and I didn't know what to do. I was afraid to get out. And somebody came out of this house to a pickup that was running. I mean, this was the only house in the area. There was nothing else around.
Right.
And he walked out and he looked. And one of the people in the car pointed to this guy. And then they went ahead and pulled on by me and took off. So I got out and I looked at the man, and he was doing something around the pickup. And so I went ahead and got my tire out and changed it and went on my way. Well, this left, you know, it made me quite fearful.
Yes.
Well, on the way back from California back to Idaho, I looked for this place. I wanted to stop, and it left such a mark on me psychologically.
Sure.
I found the place. It was totally uninhabited. No windows, no doors. Just a little shack.
Yes. And what do you think happened to you?
I honestly don't know. I honestly feel that something kept me from being harmed.
Something wanted to warn you.
Yes. It's these two guys away is what happened.
That's quite a story. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good morning. On our first first-time caller line. You're on the air. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning.
Where are you, sir?
I'm in Reno.
Reno.
Hey, my name's John. I'm from, I'm in Sparks. I've been listening to your show on spooks and goblins here. And let me turn down this radio.
No, just actually turn it off all the way. Just extinguish it.
There, it's out.
Right.
And I got an interesting story. My wife used to, or my ex-wife used to dabble with Ouija boards and what have you, and I understand exactly how you feel. I can hear it in your voice, but we were horsing around with it one night, and the following weekend, I'd gone out fishing with a friend of mine and came back later that evening, and we watched TV for a while, and then we went to bed, I guess about 11:30, 12 o'clock at night. And the back door of the house and the front door of the house were in line with each other. And our bedroom was at the other end of the house.
Right.
And I was just dozing off, and I swore I heard the back door open. And somebody in heavy boots closed the door and walked through my kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
I went to my dresser drawer, and I grabbed my 9mm, and I took it out. And I'm standing in the hallway thinking, God, I hope I don't have to do this. I got locked and loaded, and I swung out into the hallway, and there was just enough residual light in the living room where I could see the silhouette of this individual, about 6'3", pretty stocky person. And I uttered some explicatives, deleted, and told him to freeze right where he was or I was going to dump him. And you remember the old window shades where you take and you pull them down, you let them go, and they just go up and spin around?
Very well, yes.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what happened to this silhouette.
Oh, you're...
Straight up.
Really? Just like a window?
Just like the old window shades. It just went straight up and vanished. And that was a very puckering experience, if you know what I mean.
I know what you mean.
And I'll never forget it. That we had other interesting happenings in that house, too. We had clocks that would mysteriously just slide off the shelf and drop onto the floor for no reason at all.
Well, this has been sphincter tightening enough for me.
Yeah, this is a really great show. I want to get off the air and listen some more.
All right, thank you. Have a good morning. Oh boy, that's pretty descriptive, like a window, like that. That's the kind of thing that'll put you on your knees for a while. Line three, you're on the air.
Hi, Art. This is Chris in Carson City.
Hi, Chris.
I'm calling. This is a story that my brother told to me.
All right.
And I have no doubt that it's true. He doesn't engage in lying. But my brother was taken in that. First of all, my father passed away in June of 91, and he had a very sudden heart attack. I mean, I had dinner with him an hour before, and he was perfectly fine. We were joking. And
people always say that. He was fine.
He was, and we were joking about a local casino. There were alike, and he didn't. He was saying, well, if I go in there to cash a check with you, I've got to take a shower because it's so greasy, you know. And he was just joking.
Yeah.
And it was very sudden. Nobody was expecting it. He died very quickly in his rocking chair in a candy bar. And about 6 months later, my brother was taking a nap. He worked graveyard, and he had to sleep during the day. And he had somebody watching his children in the other room. Well, in his dream, he heard a phone ring. Now, he has no phone in his bedroom.
Mm.
But in his dream, he heard the phone ring, and he picks up the phone, and it's my father on the other end of the line. Now, my father was a compulsive gambler, and I think one of the things that killed him was the stress of having gambled away everything that he and my mom had.
Guilt.
And my brother said that he heard casino noises in the background. And the noises of slot machines, and he could tell that my father was calling from a casino.
Yes.
He said, I need to talk to you, and I need to make it quick. I've gambled away all my prayers, or I've cashed in all my prayers to make this call to you. And apparently, the way my dad said, he said, the way my dad had it, people pray for you, and the prayers are part of the economy of this place where he was. And as many prayers as people prayed for you, that was the things that you could do. And he was using all his prayers to make this call. And he said, I have a message for you. He said, he says, you are going to die within a year. But that's not the message. I have a more important message that I really need to get to you. And before he could get the message to my brother, the phone went dead. And my brother woke up. But he came out of the room and he didn't think much about it except that it was a dream and the stress of my father having passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And my little niece came in and said, Daddy, who called you and why is there a phone in your room? And now it's been 2 years, my brother isn't dead, and so I kind of discounted the whole thing, except that my mom said that there are different ways of dying. Now, when my dad died, my brother was always dependent on my dad for everything, and never really could hold a job, never really could do anything. As soon as my dad died, my brother started going to college, he started getting work, getting a job.
Doing all the things that had your dad lived, he would have wanted him to.
Now, I think that my dad was saying that, hey, the old Dan is going to die in a year. There's going to be a new Dan. That's the way I see it, that there's a responsive, there's a totally different man, responsible, taking responsibility in his life, doing the things in his life that he should be doing.
I've got you. I've got you.
I would like to know, though, what the other message was.
I can imagine. Thank you for the call. Thank you for the story. And a good one it was. Now, there's lots of ways to die. Line one, you're on the air.
Morning.
Good morning.
This is Joyce Button from Toppenish, Washington.
Hi, Joyce.
How are you doing this morning?
Fine. Just fine.
Good. Oh, well, first off, I wanted to tell you that I'm an Indian woman, and I really can identify with some of the things your caller's been saying. But I wanted to talk about Uncle Joe.
Uncle Joe, all right.
If you can remember that fellow.
Oh, I do very well, yes.
Okay. I was married in 1977 to a man that, well, they have a long book. I guess it dates back years and years ago. And really wasn't paying a whole lot of attention to what was going on in his life. But being an Indian woman, there's a lot of spirituality in my own family line. But I thought it was really strange is how both of us kind of came together and a lot of really weird things were happening in our life. Of course, we're not married anymore, thank God. But at the time, I didn't really understand what was going on with him, but looking back on it, I'm kind of scared that if I ever see him again, it'll be right before I die, because that fellow said, well, I got to go see Uncle Joe. Everywhere he went, and I know that his family, they were older, but he would go, like, to see, you know, he'd want to go see his aunt or his uncle or whatever, and right before he got there, they'd already be gone. And the same thing happened with a teacher that...
It would be just a sudden impulse. He didn't have these frequently, right? But when he did have them, somebody actually died?
Right. And I really wasn't paying it a whole lot of attention, you know, what was going on, until my foster father, who I was real close to, he had a terminal illness, and we all knew he was going to pass away. He was dying of cancer over on Woodby Island, and I went over there and I said, hey, I've got to go, I've got to get ready right now, and I threw my things together and took off, and I had this vision, one of the first visions I've had, and I've had quite a few since, but there was this airplane that looked like a tiny toy airplane, and these three huge angels behind it, and then you could see inside this airplane and these passengers, but this one passenger, I couldn't see their face, and it was like a real tiny airplane. And he was wearing a gray jacket. Well, my husband had to work overtime and said that he couldn't go to see my father, and they were real close. Well, he came, there was a knock at the door, and I looked out, and there he was, and I really didn't think anything of it, and I opened up the door, and there was this terrible feeling of death that just went right through me. And my foster brother, who was a nurse, literally ran down the hall, and he said, don't let me get him ready for you first. And I just got terrified, and I took a look at his face, and I said, well, let's go across the street and see the kids, because they were staying at the neighbors. And halfway through the clearing, I felt my father die, and I just felt so horrible when I felt his spirit, you know, just leave. And, of course, I knew my dad was dead, and I went and tried to get him involved with, looking, you know, seeing the children. When we got back, my mom was having a glass of high cherry wine. Dad had made always made wine and stuff, and she looked right at my husband's face, and she just with hate in her eyes, and she said, well, he's dead, you know, like he had been the one to kill him. And all of a sudden I remember that vision of that gray coat, and I looked at my husband, he was wearing that gray jacket, and it was him. He was coming, you know, in that tiny plane. And that's how he had gotten there. He had flown there, chartered a small plane to come into Woodville and taken a taxi and come to the house. And all of a sudden, all the pieces fit together, and I looked back, and I thought, oh, my God, you know, he told me that he was going down the hall right before his father died.
Well, listen, we're out of time, but if ever a woman had reason not to see an ex, if you hear he's on the way to visit you, I'd grab the nearest passport and be headed out.
I think I will.
All right, thank you. Thanks. Bye-bye. And while we're on the subject of airplanes, I have a very good friend that works for one of the major airlines in this country, maybe the biggest airline, actually. And there are some planes, and I'm intentionally not going to tell you which airline it is. Actually, they've made movies about it. But because of the violent nature of airplane crashes, companies that have been in the business for a very long time and have had crashes, no, planes are haunted. There are some bone-chilling stories to be told about haunted airplanes. And because I don't want to compromise something that's been told to me, I'm not going to pass it on to you. I'm just going to say, believe it. There are some airplanes that are that have more flying than just the paying passengers, let me put it that way. Good morning. On the first-time caller line, you're on the air.
This is Alan from Birmingham, Alabama.
Alan from Birmingham. Hi, Alan. How you doing?
Still doing the stuff on the ghost stories?
Oh, we sure are, Alan.
All right. Well, I got one for you.
All right.
All right. Me and my best friend, ever since we met, we've been having, like, strange occurrences happening whenever we're around each other.
Right.
And, you know, we could, like, know what each other's thinking. If something happens to one of us, you know, the other knows about it and things like that.
Sure.
Well, he joined the Army about 2.5 years ago.
Alan. Yeah. I have a break coming up right now. Might I ask that you hold through it so we can get your whole story in?
Okay.
All right, good. Stay right where you are. That's Alan in Birmingham, Alabama. Back with us in a moment.
Special replay of Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell. This program originally aired October 30th, 1993. Please do not call.
Welcome back, everybody, to a night of, she expressed it well. I'm Art Bell, and this is Coast to Coast AM, back to Birmingham, Alabama now. Good morning. You're back on the air. Thanks for waiting.
Yeah, all right. Okay, so me and my best friend Lance, it's like, you know, we always kind of have like sort of like the same dreams and stuff, but we was always wondering how this happened and stuff. So he got hurt while he was in basic training, and he had a convalescence leave, and I was living in Huntsville at the time.
Right.
And we was always wondering why this was happening and everything. And one night about 3 o'clock in the morning, all these dogs in the neighborhood started barking, and, you know, we was wondering what was going on, so we walked outside and looked around and couldn't see nothing. All of a sudden, we looked up in this tree, and there was these red glowing eyes. It was real freaky.
Red glowing eyes?
Yeah. Okay. And about that time, the dog shut up, and the whole neighborhood went black. We found out the next day, all Southeast Huntsville was in a blackout. And all of a sudden, there was this white Bengal tiger, like a shadow, walked up in the yard.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, it transformed, and this man, he was Egyptian. And he said his name was Ptolemy, which I found out there was a real, he's an Egyptian astrologer, a mathematician named Ptolemy, lived back in 300 AD or something like that. And he told us that what he was, who he was, and everything, and that things like this would happen, and sooner or later he would tell us why and show us why. And ever since then, we like have dreams about him and everything, and it's real weird because we'll like be dreaming.
So he, in other words, he's never really left you.
Right. It's like he said he'd be there to protect us and things like that. And Lance has had occurrences where he's protected him while he's been in Germany and everything. But one of the strangest ones was last Christmas he was at home, and me and him was out sitting in the living room and was going to leave and go outside.
Mm-hmm.
Down to his parents' house. And what happened is I went to open the door, and as soon as I opened the door, it's like both me and him went flying back into the middle of the living room. The door shut, and about 20 seconds later, a car came by with a drive-by shooting.
Oh. Well, that's quite a story.
Yeah. It kind of freaked us both out.
I understand, and I thank you for adding to the series of stories this morning.
Yeah. But thing about it is he's in Germany, I'm here, we've been both having real weird dreams lately, and I talked to him about 4 days ago. He's telling me about his dreams and the same ones I'm having.
Well, maybe there's more to go to this story. Keep us informed, all right?
All right.
Thank you, my friend. And two, you're on the air.
Morning, can you hear me?
I can hear you, but not well.
Let me see if I can make it better. Can you hear me now?
Oh, much better, yes.
Okay. What I'm going to tell you, I've never told anyone before. It's started many years ago. I was born in 1949
mm-hmm.
In April. And April 5th, 1952, 5 days before my third birthday, my older brother died. The only memories I really have of him is him laying in his coffin. He was buried 2 days before my third birthday, and on my third birthday, he came back and talked to me. Now, I was a very little child, but I remember that very clearly. Since that time, and I'm 44 years old now, every April 10th, no matter where I have been in this world, he always comes back and talks to me again.
How? I mean, what form does he take? How does this happen?
He looks exactly like he did the day he died. He looks like a four-year-old child. And it doesn't matter where I am. When I was in Vietnam, it doesn't make any difference. All I have to do is be by myself for even just a few seconds. On my birthday, he always comes and talks to me, and he always tells me. He doesn't tell me anything that, you know, is really revealing anything. He just tells me if everything's going to be okay and not to worry about it.
How do you handle that? I mean,
Well, it's been ever since I was a little tiny child, so it's normal for me. I mean, I don't tell anybody about this. I wouldn't be telling you if it wasn't on the.
What about your parents?
What who I am.
I know. What about your parents?
As far as I know, they never have any. Nobody's like he always told me to not tell anybody. So I don't. I've never heard anybody else say anything about it. So I don't know. I just know that he talks to me every April 10th on my birthday.
That's incredible. I'll tell you. I'm honored that you decided to tell us.
Well, like I say, I wouldn't tell you if you could know who I am, because he told me not to tell anybody. But like this. Where you can't know who I am, it's okay.
Thank you for the story.
You're welcome.
Good morning. Well, what do you think about that? Hmm? Sound credible to you? Sound like someone who was just calling to jerk our chain? I don't think so. Same way I feel about most all the calls we've had this morning. This has been very good. If you've listened to all this, I think that you've got to be sitting there wondering about all this. Hi there. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello? No, are you there? Last chance.
Yes.
You are. Where are you, sir?
I'm calling from Denver.
Denver, Colorado. Welcome to the program.
Yes. One thing about the ghost story thing, I was hardly ever a believer. Growing up as a Christian, I was for the most part taught not to believe in that. Back in 1984, I was dating a lady, and she had told me that through some friends of the family, she had the opportunity to go out to an old farmhouse south of the Denver area, and there was an opportunity for her to pick up some old leaded glass, some light fixtures, and some chandeliers from an old farmhouse that was on the property out there. So I agreed to go out there with her. We had gone to the old boarded up farmhouse, and bear in mind, all of the windows and the doors had been boarded over with 2x4s. And I went to the front door. She was staying in the car. It was, probably about zero out, and this was the first part of November. But we had got inside the house and went in there, and we were looking around at the different ornate fixtures that were in the home. And I looked into the kitchen, and I thought I could see a little boy about 4 or 5 years old. And I looked over there, and for a brief second, I was sure that I thought I saw a little boy there.
Mm-hmm.
And it just came and went, and I didn't think. At the time, I thought, well, maybe I was just imagining it. Well, another 5 minutes went by, and we were walking through there, and I looked over to Shelley, and I said, you know, I thought I saw a little boy in here. And she said, oh, don't worry about it. You're dreaming, this, that, and the other. And I walked into another adjoining room where the chandelier was, and had grabbed a little step stool and was getting ready to get up on that. Shelley let out this blood-curdling scream and came running in, and she said, there's a little boy in here. And I said, I thought I saw something too. So we walked around on the bottom floor of the old farmhouse. And I said, if you'll be real quiet, if we could hear him running through here, you know, we might be able to grab him and find out what's going on, because at these temperatures, the little guy is going to freeze to death in here.
Mm-hmm.
We searched through the house, the stairway. I was standing by the stairway to the second floor, so I know that nobody could have walked past me. And we just decided at that time that maybe we both saw something, or possibly a cupboard door or something caused shadow.
Mutual hallucination, something.
Apparently, and we didn't think too much about it at that time. Well, I had taken the fixture down and had deglazed some cabinet doors that had the beveled glass in it. And we went outside and ran into a friend of mine who works for the power company. And he had saw my rig out there. And he was sitting out in his pickup making a radio call. And when we walked out there and got in our rig, he said he didn't know if Shelley was my wife or not. I hadn't seen him for a while.
All right, we're almost out of time here.
I'll speed it up. We had left and gone up to the new home that was built on this farm. It was built in about the 60s.
we went up there to thank the people and got to meet the matriarch of the family, and her name was Grandma Ann. Wonderful lady. We went in there, we spoke with the people, and we said thank you for letting us have those fixtures. Shelley had walked in there to where her grandmother's little, I guess, room, bedroom, you would call it, next to a den. And we looked down and we saw a little picture of the boy and two girls.
Oh, boy. All right, I've got to hold it there. Thank you. So there was the boy. There was the boy. That's an incredible story. People coming back. People never leaving. People who die, whose spirits remain here for some troubling reason, usually troubling. What a remarkable string of stories this morning. Good morning. On our first time caller line, you're on the air. From where are you calling, please?
I'm calling from Seattle, KBI.
Seattle, yes, sir.
This happened about 11 years ago. I had a girlfriend who had been killed in a car accident by a drunk driver. She had gotten in the accident on August 18th, and on August 20th, she had been pronounced dead 2 months before her 20th birthday.
Mm.
On Halloween night exactly, there was a party at the house where she had used to live. Everyone had her roommates had decided to have a party to try and get over the grieving process and whatnot.
Yes.
We had hired a band out of Everett, and I was over at the house to let the band in. And the band that had came, nobody knew about Lisa that had died. And the head singer for the band had gone into the bathroom back by Lisa's bedroom. It was a female with dark hair. Lisa had red hair.
Mm-hmm.
She was in the bathroom combing her hair, and she let out a scream like I have never heard before in my life. I went running back there, and she's standing there in the mirror, just white as could be. And she looked at me, and she said, "Somebody has died here." And I said, "What do you mean?" And she goes, "I looked into the mirror, and it wasn't my face."
Uh-huh.
And then she said, she described Lisa right to a T. And she walked out of the bathroom and turned and looked right at Lisa's room and said, "That's her room." Well, the first thing I thought was that these people were trying to play a very sick joke. And got together with a couple other people and were talking about it. And this girl from the band kept wanting to leave. And before she had gone into the bathroom, she had been so excited about playing this gig. Later in the evening, I was standing in Lisa's bedroom talking to somebody, and I looked into the window and saw her reflection from behind me and heard her voice asking me to leave. And I left the party, and then later that night, over $10,000 damage was done to that house by people getting out of hand. And I just really believe, and you know, just sitting here recalling it, I get the shakes like I did that night. And I just really believe that she had came back not wanting people sitting there getting drunk.
I'm kind of curious about something. How has this affected your spiritual life? Since that time, what's your belief system like? I mean, are you now absolutely convinced that there is another life?
Oh, yes. I've been convinced. When I was a child, my parents owned a mobile home, and they had always told us that this mobile home was haunted and have always told this story. And we always thought they were kidding with us, trying to scare us and whatnot. And until this happened, I really didn't believe it. And, you know, I still get the shakes. I'm sitting here shaking now thinking about it.
Hearing these other stories must be a very reinforcing experience for you.
Yes, it is.
Thank you for the call.
Thank you.
And good morning. And if you're just joining us, welcome to the program. We're telling ghost stories. Real ones. The place where Halloween is really occurring, right here. It's called Coast to Coast AM. Good morning. Line 3, you're on the air.
Hi, Art.
Hello.
Some incredible stories tonight. This is Margaret at Grants Pass, Oregon. But anyway, my story dates back to 1945. And my
the year of my birth, I might add.
Oh, well, you that old? Oh my goodness.
Oh,
well, I'm 71.
Are you that old?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Yes.
Anyway, my husband had had commando training. I knew he was going into battle in the Navy and advanced echelon, and I was just worried sick over him when he left because I didn't know where he was going, what was happening and everything, you know, and I went with a friend of mine down to Alpera Street. And I don't believe in fortune telling or anything. Well, maybe I do a little bit now. But anyway, then we went into this fortune teller, and she was listening to a young girl who was there with a sailor, after she was through, I said, well, I didn't want to rush her or anything, you know. And she said, well, that's okay. All she wanted was find out whether the boy liked her or something like that, you know.
Sure.
So then I told her, you know, that I was worried about my husband, and we had only been married a short time. And she said not to worry about him, to take care of myself, that he would be just fine, but just take care of myself, you know. So I didn't think too much of it. But sometime later, I went by myself to an elderly man in Maywood, in southeast L.A., and he was a fortune teller, after he told me that he was going to be just fine and I should take care of myself, and he called me all the way out to the car, kept telling me, now you watch out, you take care of yourself.
Well, how come you didn't turn around and say, why? I mean, what's going to happen to me? I think I'd have to ask.
Yeah, well, I just didn't believe in fortune tellers, you know. I just
yeah, but I mean, we're talking same message, two tellers.
Yeah, that's right, but I didn't link them together.
Really. All right, we don't have a lot of time, so what happened?
Well, what happened was that VJ, they came, and he was just fine, and everything was going great. And in October, I had a dream that this factory I worked at, I was up on a mountain, and I was looking down, and there was a big explosion, and I rushed down there, and there was one guy sitting there, and he said, everybody got killed but me.
Oh.
And about a week later, I was involved in an explosion, and I was the only one that was hurt. And I was in the hospital, and I think the first day they had a horrible heat streak, and I asked God, I said, please let me die. This heat is terrible because all the good hospitals were filled up, and this was...
All right, we're about to not be able to continue, so I'm going to have to say we'll hold it there. Call me next hour if you can get through. Thank you. I'm sorry, but that's the end of the time. But not the end of the program, by any means. The place where Halloween is really occurring, right here. It's called Coast to Coast AM.
An old cowboy went riding out one dark and windy day. Up on a ridge he rested as he went along.
The Coast to Coast AM Archives. You're listening to the best of Art Bell. This program was originally broadcast October 30th, 1993. Art will be live tomorrow night for his annual Ghost to Ghost AM show.
If you have a story for us, come on ahead. We've only got one more hour of it, and this is it. Wild Card Line 3, you're on the air. Good morning.
Good morning. I kind of like to share a story, well, three stories, if I have the time.
All right. Where are you? Where are you, please?
I'm in Little Lake, California.
Little Lake, California. All right. Go ahead.
The first time that I ever had some sort of strange experience, I was lying in my bed with my eyes closed, and I could see these faces floating through my room. And they were a lot like the faces out of the death pits of the concentration camps. They were hollow-eyed and gaping mouths. And at first I was kind of, mystified by it, and it seemed like minutes, but I'm sure it was only seconds. And I thought to myself, well, if you're here for good, you can stay. If not, if you're here for no goodness, go. Go now. And immediately the faces disappeared. The other story, my husband was in the Pacific, and he was fighting the Japanese. And there was a young Marine that came back across the no man's land, and the Japanese were shooting everything they had, and when he got to the other, to their lines, he was riddled with bullet holes from his waist down. His legs were, all his bones in his legs were shattered. And whenever the chaplain asked how he got there, he only replied, "My father brought me back. My father brought me back." And whenever it come to find out, I think the Yank magazine wrote it up in the fact that the chaplain found out that the father had died in the Battle of Aragon or some other battle. The third one was a couple years ago here at my home. We had these footsteps constantly, maybe two or three times a month, out across the patio and wooden deck. And my husband was out in the workshop working one day, and each time we'd hear these footsteps, we'd check them out, there would be nothing there. And this particular night, he was working out in the workshop, and he thought I'd called him, and I says no. And he went on back to what he was doing, and suddenly a hammer flew across the workshop and just missed him by fractions, and there wasn't a soul nowhere.
Wow.
And, we have no idea how the hammer or who threw the hammer, but it went across the shop nevertheless.
Unmistakable message, nevertheless.
Nevertheless.
Thank you very much for your call.
Mm-hmm.
And adding to our list of incredible stories this morning. Some of these have been truly incredible. And I'm going to have to sit down and listen to a tape of this program myself. We'll be right back. First time caller line, you're on the air.
Good morning.
Hi, where are you, ma'am?
Spokane, Washington.
Spokane.
This is back in the 50s. Oh, gosh, wait, I turned this darn heater down. I'll be right back.
Oh, that's quite all right. Go ahead. We have no open lines right now. When we do, you know the numbers. Pick one and call it.
Hold up here.
Yes.
Back in the 50s, my husband and I had, he was a hard rock miner up here in Washington State, and I had gone down to California, and I tried to talk him into coming down there and get a job in the shipyard, which he used to work in, and got that all arranged, and I had a little apartment, and I went and got had a lease on a lease option to buy on a place, and I transferred my mail over to a little mailing thing. Well, he called me up and said he would be down in a couple of days. So I was busy from one place to the other and so forth. I'm driving down Vermont Avenue, and I look in the rearview mirror, and there he is in a black sedan with another guy driving, and he smiled and waved at me. And I thought, oh, that son of a gun, he got here 2 days early. I go run home and got everything ready, made a pot of coffee and everything. He didn't show up, and I had to go over to the other house. I left a note on the door, went over, took care of the apartment that I was going to rent with option to buy, and so forth. It was a duplex.
Right.
It paid for itself and everything because the beauty operator was in the other half. And I was real proud of that. Went back home, didn't hear anything. About 4 days later, I got a letter in this little mail office. The girl called me and said, "You've got a letter from up home." And I went over, picked it up, and he had written to me. And a couple of days later, I got a telegram that he had been killed the day after I saw him in the car.
Oh, gee.
I have never remarried. it was such a blow. I just couldn't believe it. I mean, he was killed. He had sold the house. He had sold our furniture. He had packed up things to ship and everything. And he was killed the day before. He was supposed to work one shift and leave and the next morning, and he was killed.
And so as a result, you have never remarried?
No. It was too much.
I understand. And I really appreciate your taking the trouble to call us.
Thank you.
Take care. Line 3, you're on the air.
Good morning.
Hello.
Are you there?
I'm here.
I just wanted to say I had an incident happen about 4 years ago. I went to my mother's house, and my mother has her grandmother. At the time, it was her mother was living with her, and she was approximately about 90 years old, and pretty well bedridden. I mean, she couldn't get out past the kitchen.
Sure.
And we went to dinner. I just happened to stop by and see her, and she said, "Let's go to dinner." And I said, "Fine." So before we left, she always keeps the windows locked. We always locked the doors. I mean, that was just one of her pet peeves. And we went to dinner. It was about 20 minutes away from where we were at. And we were at dinner, we were talking, and I never really got to know much about my grandmother. And I had said something about, well, what was my grandfather like? And we talked, and she said he was real mean and vindictive to your grandmother, and that was one of the main reasons why they divorced. And he died. He was an alcoholic, and he passed away so many years before this. So, I mean, we went into other conversations, and at the end of the evening, we went back to the house. We came out, went to the back door, and in my mom's bathroom, which is at the other end of the house, there would have been no way my grandmother could have got, because she had a wheelchair to the kitchen. That was as far as she could go, because she was in a trailer house.
Right.
And we got to the back bathroom, and I happened to go in first. And I walked in, and I was just about to shut the door, and just something told me, don't shut the door all the way. I looked up. And on the inside of the door, she had one of those length-away mirrors of the door length.
Oh, yes.
It had been lifted up past the doorway, and then it was like about 2 feet above the doorway, and it had been tightened all the way. And it had like, it probably had about 12 or 13 of those latches you screw in and tighten.
Right.
Every one of the latches was completely tight, because I just completely went over this thing. There was no forced entry. There was nobody had a key. The only people that have a key to that house is my mom and my dad, and he lived up in Ely. And this chill just ran down my back, because if anybody was to break into the house, I mean, there's been just no godly reason why they would just raise this mirror up and tighten it down like they did. And I told her to come in. I says, were you messing with the mirror earlier this afternoon? She said, no, I never messed with the mirror. And she looked in, and her face just turned white. And, I mean, it was just really weird. And we went in to check on my grandma to make sure she was all right. And she was in the other room. She was just muttering my grandfather's name, just kept muttering. I mean, she never really ever talks about him. And she just kept muttering. I mean, she didn't say, just kept saying his name over and over and over again. And, I mean, after that, I mean, I've heard stories and stuff. And I used to be skeptic about it, but never, never again. I mean, to this day, when we took the mirror off the next day, I mean, she didn't even want the mirror in the house. I took it to the dump and got rid of it. But, I mean, that is probably one of the weirdest things I've ever had happen to me, or to her, for that matter.
Well, you've told that story on the right morning, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Take care. And I know that a lot of you sitting out there listening to all this morning have got to be going through some changes, because I sure am. These aren't nuts. These people are literate, obviously well-educated, articulate, young, old, middle-aged. That last caller was just another example. How can you ignore it? Good morning. On our first-time caller line, you're on the air.
Hello, Art.
Hi.
Hi, this is John calling from Fairbanks, Alaska.
Hi, John, all the way from Fairbanks.
Yes, I want to know if perhaps you're having some poltergeists in your radio feeds tonight.
I hope not. Why do you ask?
I don't know if any other callers have picked this up. I don't know if it's in one of your network feeds or what, but periodically, starting with your first hour through your second, third hour, every so often I'd hear a background noise that sounded like a duck quacking.
Come on.
I'm recording your program, and there are quacking ducks or poltergeist or something on your program. I'm sure other listeners...
Do you have the tape there?
I have the tape going right now.
Look, Oh, well, you have it going now to record your own call.
Exactly. I've turned everything way down, but hopefully I can still record it. But periodically...
All right, I'll tell you what I'm going to do.
Okay.
I'm going to terminate this conversation with you now.
Mm-hmm.
And what I want you to do is cue your recorder to where you've got that on tape.
Okay.
And call me back and play it.
Okay.
Will you do that?
Tonight.
Tonight.
Okay, I'll try, because it's been probably an hour since I've heard it, but I'll try to get it for
you. If you can do it, call me back on the same line.
Okay.
All right?
Okay, I'll try to do that, because I wanted to share a couple stories with you.
Well, if you want to do... All right, fine. Go ahead and share. You've got time to share one now. Go ahead.
I'll try to do that, but when I went to school, I went to school with this boy, and he had a pretty rough life. He lost one brother in the eighth grade due to some childhood illness, and then a brother that was a couple years older than him went to Vietnam, and he was killed when he was a gunner on board a helicopter, and he was killed in action in Vietnam, and he led a fairly unhappy life, and we parted ways, and I joined the Air Force, and I ended up in Alaska, and I was stationed at Eielson Air Force Base, and one night he came to me in a dream, and he was very sad in the dream, and he was crying, and he expressed to me in the dream that he'd been hurt badly, and he just had a car wreck, and I just thought it was a dream, and a few days later I received a letter from my mom and a newspaper clipping that he'd been killed in a car wreck.
Oh, boy. All right.
And
well,
it was more than a coincidence.
I understand. All right. Look, let's hold it here. Call me back with that tape. Line 3, you're on the air.
Yeah. Actually, I have a ghost story that I'm still trying to resolve now. I'm trying to find out who the ghost is. However, it's kind of a mundane ghost story.
You mean this is going on now?
Yeah, where I work.
All right.
It's real mundane. He just walks through the place and doesn't bother anyone. But... When I lived in Santa Barbara, my father was a pastor of a church, and he was a part-time pastor. A small church couldn't afford to pay him. Part of his compensation was, is we lived in some apartments in the second story of the church.
Mm-hmm.
This building was built at the late 19th century, so when we were living there, maybe had 90 years on it.
Sure.
Very old, very oppressive building. Everyone I know who lived there was terrified, I mean literally terrified, to go downstairs when it was dark. And, you know, it was my job, for instance, to go turn on the lights in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
Sunday morning I had to go turn. My dad,
Gee.
Many years later, said, well, I didn't want your sisters doing that. You know, why do I have to?
Well, right. Lucky you.
Yeah. Well, I swear, we go down in the dark and there was something there. There was something there. I knew it. I found out I'm not the only one who felt that way. There were some people we knew who lived there after we did. Everyone in that family refused to go downstairs when it was dark. Any time somebody went down there, they knew something was there. Well, we later found out someone had committed suicide in that church.
Yeah, there you go.
Very many years earlier, someone committed suicide in that church. One of the people who lived there, when he was a member of the church, he lived there the same time we did.
Mm-hmm.
He, very nice guy. It turned out, this happened just a few years ago, this man murdered he just flipped out, and he murdered his mother and his father.
Hmm.
And he'd lived in that church for years. I don't know if it's connected, but he had flipped out. He murdered his mother and his father.
It absolutely wouldn't surprise me.
It made the news here in town. And this happened a couple years ago in Santa Barbara.
Mm-hmm.
He knifed his mother and father. The church was sold. A military prep school bought it and had a bunch of cadets living there and going to school there.
Right.
Some of those cadets got it in their mind to go down and kill a homeless person. The military academy got closed down because their cadets had committed murder. I went back a couple years ago, and with a friend who also used to live there, we went to the place, because she still lives in Santa Barbara. She goes, well, it's a coffee house now.
No, that's not just something you get on your mind.
Yeah, exactly. And we went to the coffee house, and now the coffee house was an occult theme. And you go in, and what I felt when I went in there by myself, and just in all the paintings on the wall, all the decorations was there. We talked to a man whose studio was upstairs in what used to be our apartments.
Yes.
He said he would not stay there at night. At night, when it got dark, he went home.
Whatever it was,
but
was...
that building was not a pleasant place.
I've got you, sir. Thank you very much for the call. I've sure got you. I'll tell you, that really does seem to go on. It does seem to stay within buildings, structures, where things have occurred. Though on other occasions, spirits, ghosts, if you want, have followed people. Not let them go. When they're part of it, they seem to get followed. Line one, you're on the air.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Art. I got a strange story. I used to live in Taiwan.
Oh, yes.
And a friend and I had were moving into an apartment. And the apartment had one bedroom, and there was two of us. So we had them put in a wood partition in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
And one night we had come home kind of late, and we had getting ready to go to sleep. And he was in his bed, I was in my bed, and we heard these noises, these strange noises, like somebody was throwing BBs on a like a refrigerator, you know, a metallic sound.
Sure.
And
I can imagine BBs on a fridge.
Anyway, I said, you know, cut it out, and he kept telling me to cut it out. You know, we were blaming each other.
Right.
So I didn't think anything of it, and all of a sudden, I kind of see my friend, and he's sneaking around this wood partition. You know, the lights are out.
Yes.
And I'm trying not to laugh because, you know, I'm kind of hiding under the covers, and I see him coming around here, and I'm saying, well, as soon as he gets to the bed, I'm going to really scare this guy because he doesn't even know I'm looking at him. And so he gets to the bed, and I throw up the covers, and I, you know, scream at him. And I hear my friend in his bed say, you know, Tony, cut it out. And I tell you, I just broke out into like a cold sweat. And I laid back on the bed, and the bed started to, like it was on the ocean, it just started to move.
This one, yeah.
And, you know, I told him, I says, hey, turn on the lights, you know, and he heard the, you know, the way I was saying it, and he turned on the lights, and I had him check the front door and the windows. And there was nobody there. And needless to say, you know, I had, like, friends stay over, like, the next week or so. I
and
keeping there.
Yeah.
And that was it.
And you say the bed moved like like ocean waves.
Like I was on the ocean. Just the whole bed was just, like, floating.
Yeah, that bothers me. Thank you very much for the call, sir. That sort of thing bothers me. That and in movies when you see doors that sort of bend inward. They don't break. They bend.
That's
totally freaky. We'll be back.
Special replay of Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell. This program originally aired October 30th, 1993. Please do not call.
Some of the stories this morning, I'm telling you. Really, you have all done very well this morning, and there's still a bit more to come, so here we go. Line two, you're on the air.
Yes, sir.
Hi.
Hi, how are you doing?
Fine.
Well, my story is... my son used to come in. He was 19 years old, and he used to pick roses all the time for me.
Right.
So one day he said that he was going to go out of state, and I didn't agree. He says, let me go. He says, I have a premonition that I don't have a long lifespan. I says, don't be silly. I said, it's anybody that's going to go first, it'll be me. He says, well, he says, promise me if anything happens to me, he says, you'll send me roses. I says, oh, yeah, and send me lilacs.
Right.
So a year later, he got in a car accident, and he passed away Christmas. We lived in an old, old farmhouse over 100 years old. The doorbell was not connected, and the doors were jammed. The one door is never open. 2 days after he died, the doorbell rang, and the doors flew open. And you could smell roses.
Oh.
You'd come back to say goodbye.
Oh. And you smelled roses.
Yeah, the smell of roses. And we were just...
How did you react emotionally when that happened?
I had a very good feeling because he came back to say goodbye to me. And I knew that there was something. That there was something. Because he was only 20 years old when he passed away.
There is something, ma'am.
Yes, definitely.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for the story. A lot of stories like that. Variations of it. People who have left didn't get finished with their business before they had to go. Good morning. On the first time caller line, you're on the air.
Art, this is John calling you back from Fairbanks.
Hi, John. Oh, yes, John.
I've edited the tapes. Now, I'm going to try to let you hear this duck quacking, and this was just a few minutes ago when you were talking to the young gentleman just before you took your station break.
Yes.
Now, if this doesn't come across from this portable tape player, I will make copies and send them to you and let you pick it up yourself.
All right, let's hear it.
Here goes. This is just from about 10 minutes ago. We'll see how this comes across the network. Here it goes.
Oh, I said, hey, turn on the lights, you know, and he heard the, you know, the way I was saying it, and he turned on the lights, and I had him check the front door and the windows, and there was nobody there. And needless to say, you know, I had, like, friends stay over.
I absolutely heard it.
Hear that?
I heard it.
That's been on your program all evening long sporadically, that duck quacking noise.
Well, I wonder if people at other affiliates have heard that.
I figured some other caller would identify it to you because I've heard it from the beginning of your show.
All right, it was clearly there. Either we have a board operator in Fairbanks who has a sense of humor, or from a source that... no doubt you suspect.
It'd be interesting to know, but I've been hearing it from your hour one on through.
All right, thank you. Thank you for the callback, and I heard it quite clearly. That was in Fairbanks. Well, what about some of you at other affiliates? Did you hear any such thing? I assure you I did nothing like that here. Nothing. You're on the air.
Good morning, Art.
Oh, good morning.
Yes, I wanted to say when I was a teenager, I was sleeping away, and in this dream, I was holding up my casket. So I was screaming, and my mother came running in, and she said, "What's the matter?" I said, "I'm holding up a casket." And she said, "Who's in it?" And I said, "Your brother." So in 2 days, she got the call. He had died.
Oh, how did she, you know, when you told her that in the first place.
I've seen his face in the casket.
How did she react to that when you told her?
She was more or less a psychic herself, and she believed that he had a sunstroke. And then another time my dad had to, we lived on the farm, and he had to go to another city in the same state, not far away. And his sister wasn't expected to live. So we didn't have a phone, so a friend had came over and told him that his sister was sick. So he went, and sure enough, about 4 days later, in the middle of the night, the clock, you know, we had a clock that struck the hour.
Sure.
And sure enough, the clock used to went bong, bong. This time it went bong, bong. So my mother said... Hey, she just died. And she did.
Well, your mother had the power then.
Yes, the clock really told us that she had died.
Thank you. Have a good morning. Coincidence? Maybe. All of these stories, coincidence? Not likely. What do you conclude? Wildcard line 3, you're on the air.
Oh, this is a true story. This is Patrick Fitzpatrick from Silver Springs, Nevada. This is a true story about an Irish and a British ghost, about whom a poem was written by William Butler Yeats called "The Ghost of Roger Casement." In it, Casement was executed by the British and the Irish government since they became independent. Wanted his body. Every year they'd ask for his body, and finally they got the body back 30 years later when a Labour government came to power. But one of
Casement's last wishes was, do not let my body rest in this place, which is England.
Yes.
So Butler wrote the poem. He said, I can't sleep at night. I hear a knocking on my door. I just cannot sleep. And finally, at the end of it, he says, it's the ghost of Roger Casement knocking on my door. And then the British guy, and of course that poem, it was published by Yeats just when Ireland was about to go in on the British side in the Second World War. And because the British government had refused to give the body back, the Irish government stayed neutral.
That's quite a story.
Yeah, William Butler Yeats, the ghost of Roger Casement.
Thank you, my friend.
Bye.
Have a good morning. Mr. Fitzpatrick. Line 3, you're on the air.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to relate a story that goes back to 1968. I was drafted, sent to Nam because of the tremendous turnover of people and whatnot. Well, I was in the infantry. We were stationed in a small fire base close to the Cambodian border.
Mm-hmm.
And it was an evening where it was our turn to go out and set up a an ambush. We set it all up. We had everything laid out so that if Charlie came walking along, we could do our thing.
Sure.
And one guy was awake. The rest of us were asleep. That gentleman woke us all up. There was six of us, and we all saw a small party of Vietnamese coming at us. They were armed and whatnot. And at the appropriate time, we sprung the ambush and whatnot. And nothing happened. I mean, they just kept right on walking through it, not even looking at us, like.
Incredible.
It was the most crazy thing that happened over there while I was there.
Imagine everybody checked their ammunition.
Well, you know, when you let go of the claymore, you know something goes.
Absolutely.
And it was the most, I mean, the country itself is a spiritual country, but then to have that happen. And I've never seen.
You know, I don't know.
Any of the other gentlemen.
I don't know if it's that.
With us.
Yeah, I don't know if it's that surprising, sir. People who die violent deaths tend to linger, and there are a lot of violent deaths in war.
I've never experienced anything like it, and I doubt if I ever will. But it was. And I've never told anybody about it.
Big effect on your life?
It. Well, without a doubt. Without a doubt, the whole thing was a big effect on my life.
Well, I'm honored that you chose this moment to tell the
story. It was a good time. Thank you.
Thank
you. Letting me say it.
Thank you. Have a good morning. Do you believe him? Did he sound crazy to you, affected? Oh, I suppose you might say that with the strain of war, combat, things like that might happen. Might be a mass hallucination. Or more likely, not. Good morning. On the first time caller line, you're on the air.
Hello, I'm calling from Mesa, Arizona.
Mesa, welcome to the program.
Yeah. This takes place on the Navajo Reservation,
mm-hmm.
Near the trailhead of Rainbow Bridge, and in the vicinity of Navajo Mountain. My father and I were camping in about 1976. And we were camping in the ruins of the old Rainbow Lodge. It had burned down some, I don't know how many years ago.
Yes.
And as we were going to sleep after we'd put the campfire out, we both felt a presence of some sort.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't see anything. It was something we both felt. The most notable thing is that my father's a preacher, a Free Methodist preacher, and he also has a master's degree in archaeology. Or anthropology, I should say. And he felt it too. I know he did, because he said he wanted to offer a prayer. And he prayed something about having a shepherd and he'll watch the sheep.
Sure.
And I guess eventually disappeared because we both went to sleep and didn't really talk much about it after that. And that was about the only thing I've ever happened close to that. close to anything ghostly.
But it was enough that you knew that it was something.
It was there. There was a definite apprehension, you know, a feeling of apprehension in the air. And I'm sure that people who have lived out on the reservation or have visited or you know, been in the sacred parts, which is, I guess, Navajo Mountain, it's part of the sacred area, have stories like this. And I'd be interested to hear from them, too.
Maybe you will. Thank you for the call.
Gotcha.
Right. The presence felt, distinctly felt. Have you ever felt that? No question about it. Something's there. Or no question about it. Something cold and not particularly welcome is in your area. It's not a trivial emotion. It's overwhelming. It comes in waves. Have you ever felt it? Line one, you're on the air.
Good morning, Art. The fellow from Fairbanks is exactly right. I've been jiggling my radio, wondering what's wrong with it tonight. Usually.
Where are you?
Anchorage, KNI. You come in usually as clear as a bell. Tonight, it's been glitches and pops and strange.
Really?
Strange. I have a story about witchcraft in the Arctic and immortality.
All right.
1961, I was visiting an old Eskimo friend in Teller, which is up on the Seward Peninsula, hop, skip, and a jump across from Siberia.
Yes, sir.
Near the Arctic Circle, a beautiful day, and this old man, William McQuillock, tribe historian for that Mary's Igloo tribe, quite a famous Eskimo and a young man. We took a skiff, went about 30 miles out of Teller to snipe for gold up a little creek at an abandoned gold mine. Mm-hmm. I was walking along the creek, and I saw something I couldn't believe. A track of a human footprint, left foot, barefoot, in the sand. The creek had just dropped, and this was very, very fresh, and I couldn't believe it. My foot was exactly 12 inches long. This was 4 inches longer than mine. One human footprint in a place where you had to walk carefully or you'd touch your rubber boots on the sharp rocks, a lot of quartz there. I called William and his cousin over and said, "What is this?" He took one look, turned, and started walking away, both of them. About a mile back down to the skiff, and I couldn't figure out what's wrong with him. He acted afraid. I went down, and after a lot of persuasion, he told me a story of the most famous shaman. Turn of the century, there was a huge Eskimo, nearly 7 feet tall, he said, a huge man, who traveled amongst the villages. Strangely, he'd show up 150 miles away in one day. He preached to the people. He healed the sick. He even raised the dead, William told me. A young boy had died, and he put a tent over the grave, crawled in, a big noise, a roaring sound, and he walked out with the boy. This is a famous shaman. Turn of the century, the great Nome Gold Rush. The army came to try to keep order. They had a law that no witchcraft could be practiced. Well, this huge shaman showed up outside of Nome, and a troop of soldiers went out with a captain to arrest him because he was preaching revolt, warning the people, the Eskimo, against the coming white man. He said, "You cannot do anything to me. I have powers greater than you." And he had a man take a spear and stabbed him to prove it. Spit on his hands, rubbed his side, and there was no scar. And the captain almost went nuts, but he arrested him. They put him on a boat to take the shaman to Seattle for trial, and a storm immediately came up and was about to sink the boat. And they looked, and the shaman, instead of being in the brig, was sitting on the stern looking back at the land. So they put him back in the brig. A few minutes later, he was back on the deck. The captain went berserk, and the sailors turned the boat around and put the shaman back ashore near Nome. And
I'm sure.
Told me, "Now you know about the track. He is still here." 61.
Oh, that's a great story. Those are great stories. Thank you for the call.
Good evening.
You take care. Now, sailors, sailors particularly, wouldn't sail under those conditions. And you know that goes for sailors today, too. It hasn't changed. You don't venture out to sea with that sort of thing around you. You don't do it. You just don't do it today or then. Good morning. On the first-time caller line, you're on the air.
Hi, this is Mark again from KNZR in Bakersfield.
Hi, Mark.
I just wanted to say real quick, you haven't heard any quacking ducks, but we've had a similar experience before about a month ago during your show.
What did you hear?
And some ladies had called up during business hours and said they kept hearing someone saying they were going to kill them way in the background.
Really?
Yeah. So I don't know, maybe somebody along the line is...
Well, you never know, of course, Mark, as you well know, you would have the power there to make something...
Yeah, they thought one of us was doing it or something.
I see. Well, I appreciate the information. I find it a little unsettling, though.
Yeah, okay, just want to let you know.
Thank you, Mark.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye. That's a board operator there in Bakersfield. Well, that unsettles me a little. Line two, you're on the air.
How you doing, Art?
Okay.
I got a story about my uncle who died about 3 years ago. He died about 2 o'clock in the morning.
Mm.
So we all go to the hospital and, you know, condole my aunt. And then it was, you know, getting pretty early in the morning, so we all went home for a few hours. And then we came back. And as we all come back in the morning to her house, there's this dog that has just parked itself outside the front of the house. And every time somebody got out of the car who was part of the immediate family, the dog came up to them, sat there until you petted it, and then walked away. And as soon as the whole immediate family who was there, you know, came to the house, the dog went away, and we never saw the dog again.
What? What, do you have any idea what dog this was, or?
It looked like a little terrier or something.
Well, not what kind, but whose or why it did what it did? Any idea?
I don't know, but it was just a little tiny dog that was so full of life, and it, I mean, my uncle was the same way. Here was a guy who was just so full of life, and it was just strange. It waited to greet everyone that came to the house, and after everyone got there, the dog was gone. We never saw it again.
Boy, that's really something.
Really weird story. I don't know what it was, but it's weird.
I thank you for the call.
You're welcome.
You take care. Good morning. On the first time caller line, you're on the air. Hello there.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You're on the air. Turn your radio off, please.
Oh.
Turn it off. All the way off.
It's off.
Very good. Welcome to the program. Where are you?
Fairbanks, Alaska.
Fairbanks. Yes, sir.
And quack, quack.
Yeah.
Anyway, I want to go back to this story from this guy from Alaska, that Anchorage. And you don't want to believe anything that anybody from Anchorage tells you because they're full of bull.
Well, now, is that
a... about the shaman, that is really ridiculous.
Well, now, was that a kind thing to say about a sister city?
Sister city? Oh, they think they own Alaska, for God's sake. I've lived here all my life, 65 years in Fairbanks, and I don't like Anchorage. Okay. You got her.
Yeah, you know, thank you very much for the call, sir. Never let them know who you are. I guess I'd better take a second out and do as I always try to do and say thank you for wonderful talk radio. Another truly wonderful week of talk radio.